He's helped out the bottom lane. Well, is it any surprise that Snowflower has started to roam a lot more into the mid lane? If we remember the KT Arrows, how much help did Hachani give to just wandering into the mid lane for Rookie with Kakao and really snowballing that while Arrow just played safe at the bottom side and they kind of just let him hang out to dry? I'm seeing a lot of similarity in the way that Anarchy plays around the mid lane with the support to what we saw the KT Arrows do.
That's why it's kind of hilarious. They had an interview and they're like, yes, Hachani's come out. He's really helped our 2v2 laning. Apparently his advice was, just pack up and leave him. It's all good.
Pretty funny stuff. Well, there's a Zed ban against Mickey, and that is becoming increasingly necessary when Anarchy has the red side, as well as Azir versus Sassen.
Three mid lane bans on patch 5.11, super interesting to me. What were you seeing in terms of pick and ban trends yesterday? I only caught some of the games. What was sticking out?
I mean, the priority doesn't seem to have really changed in this patch. We still see a lot of the Kalista, the Ryze bans, etc., especially on the red side. Alistar, Grog is still first pick worthy. The Zed and Ahri are surprises, but this is them trying to deal with Anarchy's pocket picks right here.
That's at least three out of the six MVPs that Mickey has picked up were on the likes of Zed and Ahri, so just a lot of respect.
The problem is that Mickey has diversified. Remember, he's on red side. He can play that Kassadin. He can play Victor, and it's not going to be quite as easy to ban him out as it was previously. The LeBlanc still up as well. Obviously, LeBlanc nerfs in this patch do make her less attractive than she once was.
Ryze hasn't been touched, so has to be banned away on the red side. Probably the big champion that pops out to me is that Thresh, the big priority pick for Snowflower. We've actually seen teams start to ban the Thresh against Snowflower to try to curb some of that roaming impact. No support ban other than Alistar put out by Spend on it. Doesn't necessarily look like they'll prioritize that as the first pick. A lot of strong junglers available at the moment.
I think you have to take the Gragas here because the problem that you run, they're going to take the Sivir. The problem that you run into when playing against Lyra, instant lock Fizz, that is a bit of a surprise here.
Definitely a very big flex pick. We have seen one jungle Fizz, but probably going to be between the solo lanes. Can't see a Trundle being locked in.
How is this going to affect things? Because, of course, Mickey is going to be able to play that as well. And, yeah, that is quite surprising. Usually in the LPL, you see Fizz locks this early. Not so much here in Korea.
Yeah, the Fizz priority, the Fizz flex pick nature is a big thing in the LPL. I was going to make the same point myself. Definitely a champion that fits Mickey's play style. Definitely something Ixun may be experimenting with, of course, just the popularity, kind of the oppressive nature of how many picks in China there's been of this Cinderhulk Fizz means that it has been quite a common first round pick.
And this is very confusing because the Grog is not selected yet. And that's been such a, Lyra has been so good mechanically on Gragas that you'd have to think that Anarchy was really going to prioritize that champion. Now, I don't know how much they care about giving it up to Ketch, who has been an extremely ineffective jungler. So far this season, he's played the Echo, he's played a lot of Gragas. Teams just aren't afraid of letting him have the Gragas because he doesn't do much with it, frankly.
You could say maybe this is the perfect learning environment for Anarchy to try something out of the norm. Maybe don't play that Assassin-centric mid comp. They've already picked up the Fizz, but they're not necessarily bound towards having an Assassin mid laner. We know that Lyra can play Gragas. Maybe this is the time that you show a new threat and force the bans away from Gragas in a future series. Again, we're only speculating. Snowflower, such a wonderful Thresh player. It's always great to see him because it does really help their roaming game, but Anarchy haven't really shown much, and same with Spenno. No comps are really tilting their hands yet.
And, of course, Ixu's been playing overwhelmingly the Maokai and the Hecarim. Those have been his two preferred picks this season, so getting it for free right here might be a bit interesting. They should just pick support and top, or they should pick support and jungle right here. Definitely should not be showing too much in terms of that flex pick on the Fizz. Rek'Sai still available if Lyra wants to go for that. He pretty much has full reign of the jungle at the moment. I can't blind pick a Yasuo.
I mean, words like can't are very strong, Monty.
Interesting.
You can see the Korean cast is gasping as we saw the potential Yasuo blind pick, but as you mentioned, no real reason to do so.
All right, so here's what we know. Sangyun just switched his summoners upon locking in that Hecarim to the Ignite, so he's going to be running the Ignite Hecarim instead with the Trinity Force. But will this Fizz be jungle or mid lane is the question. We may see Spenu pick around that. Very odd draft from Anarchy. Right there, you'd almost certainly just pick a jungler, unless they're... This is an early lock for the jungler. Now, we've seen that jungle Fizz from Incredible Miracle, Tucson playing the Devour. It was terrible.
I think there's a way to make jungle Fizz at least semi-work, but Devour a Trinity Force, going into an auto-attack build on a melee carry and then parlaying that into a bit more burst was definitely not the way to do it. You could maybe see a tanky build a bit like someone like the Echo would put together. What you can say about this draft is it does force a super defensive mid lane choice from Spinner. You have to take the likes of Lulu because there is a very high potential Fizz mid from a player like Mickey.
And this is one of those points. So we've seen Spenu kind of ape other team strategies. They try and play the Juggernaut from the Koo Tigers. Now they're trying to play that SK Telecom pick comp with
Jeanette
the Sivir and Lulu.
Put this together as well and did very good on it. Monty, I want to see the Yasuo.
Do you?
It's not a bad Yasuo comp. They got the knockup from Fizz.
They
have the knockup from Hecarim. They have the knockup from Thresh. They have mixed damage. Not the craziest time to pick a Yasuo.
It isn't, and it would fit Mickey's profile. Oh dear.
We've been wondering what's in the water in Korea. Teleport Smite Yi has always been a thing, but it's Faker who's trying to push it towards another role.
I mean, I don't think this is the best comp for the Yi, especially with the Fizz jungle, but you do have... I would actually rather see the Yasuo here, but if you have enough disruption with that Hecarim, you may be able to allow the... Yes, mid-echo from Mickey.
This is exciting. So this is a much more meta pick, and it's also something... We want to see these stereotypical assassin players pick the Echo, and now we see the true one, although the flex pick is there.
I don't know what's going on anymore.
Keen almost had a little smile there from Gravity as we saw the Hecarim mid being considered.
Players having a good time. Well, they don't have to lock in their champions until 20 seconds. Those are the rules here in Korea. That gives the enemy enough time to change their rune and mastery pages accordingly if necessary. So,
crazy thing is, I'd say the Echo jungle is more reliable than Fizz jungle.
Absolutely
so.
It is. I think that it's definitely more reliable, but I don't know if you can play Fizz feasibly into this Lulu with that early game harass.
Yeah, the big thing that Echo brings is, of course, ranged wave clear on Assassin, so you throw out that Time Winder, you can clear the backline from about Merlin Omicron or level 9, 5 points in the Time Winder, so you're definitely not going to be matching wave clear with a Lulu who can just freely auto from safe range and clear very, very early, but much more reliable mid lane matchup. Not necessarily big kill pressure, but it's much safer than Fizz, like you mentioned.
Well, this is going to be an interesting game. You and I had chatted. What if Mickey plays Echo? He's one of the players we're very excited to see play this champion. The only mid lane Echo we've had so far has been Coco from CJ Entis in a game which his team lost, even though he had a pretty good performance. But Mickey's the kind of player with those Zed tricks that you really want to see on this champion. So, exciting times. We're going to get into game one. Spenu's Sonic Boom versus Anarchy. Wow.
It's very early here in Seoul.
Everyone is super hyped today, Papa Smithy.
It's actually a good crowd, a massive crowd, but the core leaders must just not get off school before 12, Monty. What to say?
Of course, in the middle of the day right now. All right. So, do we have hope for this jungle Fizz this game? Will it not be such a horrendous build?
I think with the
standard build, I think maybe it's okay. Maybe like Trailblazer and then just going so you have the a little bit more AoE and then the Cinderhulk might be decent.
All right, so he has attack speed, runes, and AP. So that's probably what you need for early jungle clear. You might think, oh no, it's already Devourer. But of course, even champions like Sejuani and to a lesser extent, Eve will pick up runes to help you with your first clears. Of course, items can help you to scale into the late game. Runes just help you get through the jungle safely. Very slow, single target focus in the jungle, but as you mentioned, does he go tanky? Does he try to build ability power? You never really know with a jungle Fizz. There's just no consensus build for this pick.
All right, Mickey hanging back for another potion right here. So going with the flask in this harassment heavy lane. Soul just going to pop down some saplings there, and we are going to see the junglers start both on the top side of the map and small camp standard lanes. Snowblower on that Thresh that he specializes in so heavily in in-lane. Soul going to take the first camp, actually. Hit level 2 and then help out with the second. We've been seeing this jungle start more and more in Korea. Instead of the top laner just trying to tank a camp by themselves, the jungler just goes ahead and sacrifices it. And this is really a reaction to possible lane swaps and walking into the enemy jungle, I believe, because that means there are two people there in case you do get harassed by a support in the enemy jungle. It also means that you can start a small camp instead of starting at the buff. If you're afraid of that on a weak side. So this is a more safe way to jungle at the current time in case there's a lane swap you don't expect.
And some, one small thing as well, Monty, is that it changes the timers. We always see the Maokais throw down the sapling, spend, what, 20, 21 seconds trying to clear that first camp. Suddenly now, the jungle follow is much faster. Yep. So I think it's just a different use of time. Maybe it's more effective. I haven't really done the timers, but it's something different. It doesn't really change the kind of mechanics or what really transpires in the first minute of jungle follow.
No, but I really like it. I think it's very cool that this is the reaction to what we saw earlier this season where we were talking and saying, well, what's up with this weak side? Basically, the development was, in case of a lane swap, if you started on the weak side of the jungle, and you started at Gromp or Krugs, by the time you got to the buff, the enemy support was in there just, you know, messing with you as you tried to do that jungle follow. In this situation, you don't have the same split. Oh, a little bit of action right here. Oh, Secret getting pulled under the turret, has to flash.
Yeah, you know, that tanky on this Nautilus doesn't even have a point in the Titan's Wrath. It doesn't even have that effective 10% bonus health. So now suddenly, you're going to have to play that much more defensive in bot.
So to continue my very long-winded point about lane swaps,
I'm
and
interested.
Jungle
I'm
starting,
listening.
Which is, you and I are probably the only ones interested in this. But basically, if you had to get your top laner low off of a nearby camp and you were leashing in some way, it just allowed the support to harass more. And then we saw, of course, the adaptation, which is just start at the buff so that you're gone by the time the support gets there. And now you see just quickly doing the first buff, giving that level 2 over to the top laner, and then moving on from there. It does make you more support harass independent. Mickey, gonna dodge the hook right there on the roam.
Yeah, this time it's actually Spenu who has the multiple members in mid lane. No sign of Snowflower yet, but you know he'll work his way over.
The ultimate kill pressure right here with the Fizz and the Thresh. Lots of burst if they can get in that mid lane.
So let's return to the point about level 1s. I know the viewers are just standing there listening about level 1s. I guess the only thing I can add to what you said was very succinct and correct, but I guess the small thing that I've noticed about this particular start is that you don't need any extra information about a lane swap to actually engage in this jungle follow. You do it. Your timers don't matter. You don't need to do those deep wards and try and guess, is there going to be a jungle follow? Should I be going for this first camp or not? If you're just following your jungler, you get that level 2. If it's standard lanes, fine, you walk top. If not, it that doesn't throw off your timers. So it's a lot more reliable, and there isn't that risk of someone dying on that early jungle invade.
Yeah, so I think it's just a more well-rounded start.
I know you like safety, and that's
I
the safe
do.
Choice.
Safety first, Papa Smith.
In a game with Fizz jungle.
Well, it is Trailblazer this time, so, and we'll see what enchantment he goes. I assume it's just going to be Cinderhulk, the safe way of playing. And, you know, with such a mechanical jungler like Lyra, I'm not really surprised to see the Fizz come out, and I'm less alarmed than when Tucson played it, because Lyra has shown that he has the mechanical chops to kind of back this pickup.
Look, I think there are situations where Fizz jungle is fine. It's just Spen who have chosen the most safe lanes possible when it comes to two assassins or burst damage ganking a lane. When you're talking about Echo and Fizz, you're thinking of massive burst potential post six for both champions, whatever the Fizz is building. But of course, Lulu, the most defensive lane option, can hang back, can wave clear from range. Maokai, again, super tanky once he gets to level 6. And even the bottom lane, you drop one of those spells with the spell shield and the burst potential goes down. So Spenu do have a very good comp for dealing with the Fizz jungle snowball. And after that snowball phase, what does Fizz jungle really provide? We still remain to be convinced. Is it looking for a turret dive on a level 6 Maokai? Don't know how this is going to work.
I don't think they can go for that this early. And, you know, for those who haven't seen this composition that was really pioneered by SK Telecom, basically, this composition is very weak in terms of damage output in the late game. This is not a comp that you can 5v5 with come 4 core items or so. You have to create picks. It's about speed. It's about finding someone and collapsing on them very quickly with hard engage and the Whimsy and the Sivir ult. The 5v5, just not very strong. There's no damage except for Sivir late game, really, whereas most compositions would run another threat here. So it's about how well they can make those picks. We've seen Jhin Air do very well with a similar style of composition. But by that token, the Ku Tigers tried to run it earlier this season and fell absolutely flat on their face when attempting to do so. So it's not easy because you don't play it like a Juggernaut, where the Sivir is in, or the AD carry is in front, and you ult the AD carry with the Wild Growth and kind of bait them and siege with it. You have to be very decisive and collapse all in. Well, here's a gank. Hook misses.
Sarsen didn't actually have enough mana for Wild Growth in that particular situation, so a successful hook could have been a big gank coming through from Snowfire. And I think it's ironic that, of course, the Ku innovated the Juggernaut. It feels like SKT's reaction was these Sivir and Lucian Lulu-based comps as well. So, of course, both of them using that Lulu mid-pick to such a high degree. Jhin Air really did ape it well and pulled it off excellently against Ku to give one of the only recent losses in Champions history to Ku, of course, who've been on such an uptick. If you play this comp well, even if you don't feel like you hit your timings, you look at a comp with the likes of Maokai, Lulu, Sivir, and you think, okay, if you don't pick up those early objectives, you might really fall hard. You just get so much speed in the mid game, and one pick does translate so cleanly to potentially multiple turrets when you have the likes of Sivir, Lulu do excellent turret damage, that this comp always feels to be relevant just because it does so many things and has so little counterplay for the enemy because of that sheer speed from the Whimsy.
Yeah, the big factor though is you need vision control, and even very good teams have trouble winning the vision game against Anarchy. Because if you don't have vision control, you can't collapse on somebody to make the pick. And you have to group at that objective quickly and wait for your enemy to misposition, maybe not group quite fast enough. And I'm not sure Spenu has the foresight or the warding to make that happen. Right here, they do have some good wards, however, around this blue buff. Try a little bit of a steal at the moment.
Orky and Thresh look to be reacting. It's already falling very low. They do use the smite. No, actually, they're able to donate it over. Both of them have a blue, so hard to say who secured it. But the result, of course, with Catch using his smite, is that two blues are over to Spenu, which should help their laning quite a lot.
Yeah, and they do have that early lane bully as well. Mickey going for a Sheen here into the Codex. I mean, basically, the way I look at Echo these days is, yeah, you can get the Morello Nomicon. We are on 5.11 as well. And then it's about the Lich Bane and the Zhonya's Hourglass. The Lich Bane, really key to maximizing his burst on those auto attacks, which he already does so well with the passive. We're going to look for a little gank right here. He's got level 6. He is going for the Cinder Hulk. Has the Cinder. Going to be found out by the Sapling.
Yeah, Catalyst is already completed, so once again, ganking the Maokai can be super difficult. I think Morello Nomicon was optional in the previous patch, but 100 mana cost on his ultimate just makes him so much more mana constrained that I think you have to pick it up. Dragon goes down. They notice that Tucson, sorry, that I only think of Tucson when I see Jungle Visit. Lyra's on the top side of the map, so they get a free dragon. So good play by Spenu.
Yeah, and Spenu hasn't had as many issues in the early game. In fact, they were quite competitive with the Juggernaut comp against SKT, but they just can't actually close out or even contest objectives in the late game. They make a lot of errors in terms of their play on the map as the game goes on. But that was a very decisive attempt at the dragon right there. They know they have that early game power over the mid lane with Lulu, and of course Corki not having completed his Trinity Force yet.
So Anarchy and Spenu, realistically, even come the end of the season, remember we're only just at the halfway point of the season as we reach Saturday's games. These teams are going to be competing at the bottom four. As we see Mickey coming onto Sarsen, already a lot of burst damage. Paolo Convergence is down. Will he get the stun and shield? Shield comes through, but no stun.
Sarsen just on the outside of that, expecting it to come through, but some nice harassment. And, you know, the Zhonya's is really important for Echo. And because one of the things that you want to do is get that shadow involved in the team fights with your ultimate. And what Zhonya's does is, because it's a 4-second follow on his shadow, is it cuts 2 seconds off that follow. So if you can get into a team fight and then Zhonya's and then get your ult in as you wait for your shadow to catch up, that is one of the most effective ways to play him at the moment.
And deceptively, both offensive and defensive utility in that decision, whether you want to get in or out depends when you want to pop your Zhonya's. But as you mentioned, cutting down time, a new champion. The trade damage, the auto attacks are doing massive damage to the Sus and the ults, but Fizz is here as well. This is going to be first blood, but at what cost?
Well, maybe the cost of Lyra. He goes down, catch right there to finish it. Snowflower takes Mickey out with the lantern, but leaves Lyra a little bit high and dry. Still, though, kills for each jungler, assists for each mid laner, so pretty net even in the end.
Worth noting that Anarchy used three members to the two of Spenu, but given the evenness of the trade and the back timings, no CS advantages anywhere. You're going to give the first blood over to Anarchy and the slight advantage.
Yeah, just a subtle, subtle edge right there. Nice reaction from Ketch in that mid lane. Mickey with that all in, but you got to wonder, Sasin actually got hit by the parallel convergence there. It seemed like he had plenty of time to realize that ability was going to be incoming.
Well, he died with his flash available, which doesn't seem like on a champion as defensive as Lulu, that should ever be the case.
If you have that mobility from the Whimsy and you have the flash available, does it make a lot of sense to get hit by a parallel convergence, that very slow-moving AoE ability in the mid lane?
Quite so much setup time, you'd think that over the course of the 3 seconds, not even the half second warning timer, but the 3 second cast time, you could really expect what was going to come out of Mickey and get away from it. Maybe you just use the polymorph and flash defensively instead of using the Whimsy. Either way, it seems like an unnecessary death. Speaking of unnecessary, Secret takes a lot of free orders.
Yeah, right there walking into the lane, and Song Yun gets out of range of the hook from Secret, a hook also missing for Snowflower. Lyra now down here, unseen for the lane gank.
The unseen Fizz.
Is he the deadliest?
Might prove to be. Definitely going utility build. This is what we've seen of Jungle Echoes as well. Pretty much the same exact build. Sights turn into what we can only assume will be some cooldown reduction. There's always the potential of a snowball Trinity Force, but you don't really want to itemize into it unless things are going vastly different to this game.
And that's the question, right? Is if you're going to do this build on a jungle champion, isn't Echo just better to do it on with his faster clear speed and the fact that he's still going to be doing decent damage with his passive, even through a tank build, and he brings a lot more zoning and utility than Fizz does.
See, the only thing I'll disagree with you on that particular line of thought is this is a sole damage threat comp from Spenu, and I do really respect Fizz's ability to just mess someone up in the backline, throw down the fish, CC for a long time. Mickey's going super aggressive, but with the lantern, can get away easily.
Yeah, just tapping.
Free damage.
Yeah, it's a little bit of free damage right there. And Snowflower, really his lantern play with Mickey and that synergy has developed so nicely this season so far and been a key reason behind a lot of their wins.
But that's why Ku was so adept to understand, okay, Snowflower and Mickey definitely on the same wavelength. Lyra and Mickey almost exclusively playing around each other. Snowflower and Sangyun, it's not really a duo you have to talk about, even though this is the streaming duo, of course, have had a lot of game synergy playing on stream on the Korean server. In competitive, these two playing together hasn't been a factor.
Yeah.
At least in any of the impressive Anarchy wins.
Timewinder right there, out just to zone out. Sauce in a little bit, take some hits at the pink ward. Ixu and Zol in the never-ending top lane war.
But yeah, Fizz's ability to annoy a single threat has to be respected. So the more CDR comes through, just get in the backline, auto attacks. If you hit the fish, we're talking about the double slows and, of course, the knock-up. So I think that might be the unique factor for the Fizz this game. Is it going to be relevant given just all the reposition and speed on Spenu? Maybe not, but with its soul damage threat, I respect the jungle Fizz.
You have to remember that they picked this without knowing that this was a soul damage threat composition. So
they also picked it without knowing if it was going to be top lane, mid lane, or jungle, mate.
Well, we don't know. I don't think Ixu is going to be the first one here to hop on the top lane Fizz. Just
he wouldn't be the first.
He wouldn't be the first, but just in terms of his preferential champions this season, he hasn't shown a lot of diversity.
Still a lot of priority on the home guard boots from Hecarim, despite that being the target nerf that Riot chose to do for the Hecarim. It feels like maybe that initial 1,300 gold isn't necessarily worth the power spike, because Dragon's been started by Spenu. This would be the second, but Anarchy's vision around Dragon, this is actually something very uncommon for them, is almost non-existent.
Yeah, they're just giving them up early right here. No contest on these objectives. Nuclear just going to go ahead and he has that vision, so he goes and blocks the chain or the hook right there from Secret with the spell shield, making sure that no counterplay could be made. if Snowflower wanted to follow up on the death sentence over the wall. So, yeah, just surprisingly passive. But can you blame them? I mean, Anarchy's running a composition that has a distinct item power spike with the Trinity Force on the Hecarim, with the Trinity Force on the Corki. And so by not contesting early, they're not fighting in a power trough. So they just have to fight the third one now.
I think we should give Anarchy that benefit of the doubt. It's always risky when you're talking about a bottom four team to give them benefit of the doubt about a strategic misplay. But given how consistently good this team, which is bottom four, but certainly not bottom four in terms of vision, the vision game has been, to just not ward, basically they're saving the gold. They seem to be spending much more gold on items than necessarily consumables like wards that has been traditionally their play in previous games. Maybe they have been that savvy to understand that their power spikes, they're at 25 to 30 minutes, not the first 20 minutes of the game.
Yeah, and we're seeing too, now the Lichbane done. I mean, once Anarchy and Ixu in particular pick up that last Trinity Force, their burst damage on three of their champions is going to be enormous. So they have to be very careful.
So given the items that are completed, remember, double Sheen items completed in terms of Lichbane and Trinity Force for the Mickey and Sungyun respectively, double Sightstone, surely the big thing for Anarchy to do is play around bottom lane, take out that turret and start the split push with Lichbane Echo and the defensive wards from the double Sightstone they've got completed. Lichbane Rush means one thing, and that means no team fights right now. And honestly, against a team comp that basically is solely about rotations, picks, and team fights, that could be very, very powerful.
Yeah, well, it's all about how Anarchy comes through in the next few minutes of this game.
And just set up that split push, as you mentioned. Just try and get it going. And with Trinity Force, they have the power spikes to DPS down a turret if they can get a pick of their own.
Ixu must be getting very close to the Trinity Force at this stage.
Triple Trinity Force, triple Sheen items, at least double Trinity Force and the Lichbane.
Catch!
Doesn't really have a lot of damage though. This is not Devourer of Fizz.
So. No, it's not. Still some further invades here from the Anarchy bottom lane. And Mickey continuing to trade very aggressively, seeing if he can get that parallel convergence. Gets scared though.
Draws out the Polymorph though, so the Whimsy now not available. Ixu doesn't have the Trinity Force, but still playing aggressively in round Sol. Getting chipped out of lane and just wants to cause enough pressure, whether that's fake or implied pressure, to just farm this Trinity Force safely.
Implied pressure. These are phrases that you only hear when you have the double color cast going.
Implied pressure. You watch yourself. Well, I've got some implied pressure after this broadcast, Monte Cristo.
I'll have to I will have to watch out for that because, wow, interesting. Not sure what that means in real life.
I'll leave it in there.
I don't know if I can handle your innuendo today, Bob Smithy.
So Mickey just, try and mess up Sarsen where he can, but just really no solo kill pressure. Snowflower. Around mid, as always.
I just like how he occasionally just wanders into mid and throws out the random hook. It's like the third time we've seen it this game.
But look, he's not needed in bottom. His AD carry wasn't there, so why not just give it a go? Just
give it the old college try.
And that's why it's hilarious when they have the interviews and they're like, oh yes, we developed this new strategy of playing around Mickey. Meanwhile, in 100% of their games, they've played around Mickey.
You know, a lot of other supports, maybe they take a nice wander topside and try for a lane gank right there with the Hecarim, but no. Not Snowflower. Goes for the old predictable walk into the same side of the lane that I'm laning on and then throw out a Q.
So I guess what's your take on Anarchy have basically spent their early game building damage. Trinity Force top laner, Lichbane mid laner, Trinity Force bot laner. The third dragon is coming up in a minute and a half, and you can think, okay, that's three sources of burst damage, delete someone and take the dragon, but it's going to be difficult against a team that has the lure, has a lot of defensive and utility options. Do you just try and stay in the lanes, maybe fake down a teleport and just try and push top lane and start breaking the outer ring of turrets and start the split push, or are you pressured to fight for this third dragon if you're Anarchy?
No, I think Anarchy has a poke advantage right now, and they will be able to engage upon this properly. Also, Catch, he just got this Aegis of the Legion, which actually isn't that helpful. It's helpful against Corki and Echo, but in terms of the itemization of the two Trinity Forces, not really going to help in that regard. So any kind of strong engage from Ixu or auto attack range from Songyun, it's not going to be that big of an item spike right here. And Sasan also still struggling to get that death cap. He hasn't completed it. And he's not going to by the time the dragon comes up either. So I think Anarchy's in a place where they could fight this, especially if they get some poke down first.
And a pick from the likes of the line skill shots of the Fizz ultimate and the death sentence coming through in Snowfall. A pick, the damage is certainly there. It's the CC that's much more unreliable when it comes to actually getting that first pick against, as we mentioned, all the utility of the likes of Lulu and Maokai.
Well, I think they have to do something around this next dragon, though. They have plenty more wards than we've seen previously. Mickey a little bit chunked out right here, but he is in control of the wave. And now, Anarchy starts to group. They want this Scuttle Crab. And wait for it to... Oops, it's not being very compliant right now. Wow.
Throw out a smite, but there's another one available for catch, so it won't be relevant when it comes to the Dragon War.
Yeah, that crab actually, the pathing on it was a little wacky right there. Kept going back without those auto attacks coming in. So Spenu's starting to move in.
Hecarim's starting his port, though. So home guard pressure definitely inbound.
And they go for this. There's the fish going down. It's going to miss. Catch just body slams over the wall. Parallel convergence. Not there. Ixu comes in with a home guard teleport. He doesn't have an angle, however. Meanwhile, Sol is right in the front line. And there you go. Everyone just auto-attacking him. He's going to go down eventually, but so many members of Anarchy low right now. Ixu has to get out. Songyun still at full HP. Mickey, can he get back in? He's getting chunked down by the Glitter Lance right now. It's all up to Nuclear. Nuclear has to flash back. Sasan has no mana, and a very sloppy teamfight as Fizz goes back in, but that's going to be an ace for Spenu as Hecarim just can't find an angle, and Sol able to do a lot of work by teleporting directly into the front line.
A big 5-for-2 trade for Spenu. Don't even have to really rush the dragon. They're going to take an outer turret, the first turret of the game. Lots of squishy damage threats. Remember, Hecarim only just had a null magic mantle. Damage was what's being built. We're going to see the replay coming through. They just couldn't really fight in this particular choke. There was no pressure onto the backline. You can see Nuclear and Sasan in the backline free auto-attacking, and although Anarchy are poking in and out with Sheen procs, they're just not tanky enough to play like this.
Right, and the big problem, too, is that Ixu went right back onto Maokai instead of trying to zone out Sasan or Nuclear, so he could have made much more of an impact on the back line of that fight. A quadra kill in the end for Nuclear.
Out of nowhere, suddenly starts piling some big items, already are gone for the Avarice Blade, so approach the early game in the investment banker sense that we see so much from Sivir. Really paying off now.
Yeah. Righteous glory done for Sol. So a big team fight win, a very healthy lead for Spenu. But I have to temper this. We've seen this before from Spenu. We've seen them get into the lead in the early game. Now they have the three dragons, though. But inevitably in the late game, they always seem to make that error that costs them so, so much.
Anarchy have definitely focused their early game on damage and just trying to finally force the split push scenario that we're not sure Spenu can deal with. They've taken the outer turret finally. They've taken the blue buff almost instantly. And with triple Sheen items, they're going to keep pushing.
Well, that's the crazy thing. The five-man fast push here is going to just absolutely cleave through two turrets based on all those Sheens, because there's no counterplay from Spenu. They can't get there soon enough. They trade 2-for-1. They're going to go for an early Baron, it would appear.
They have incredible Baron damage. They haven't been spotted out by the smart ward there is from the top on Spenu. There's going to need to be a face check. No, they've definitely got the information they needed. Sivir's pushing in bottom, but Hecarim, of course, will be there to answer that.
Yeah, so, but a very favorable trade from behind for Anarchy. Getting a Tier 1 and a Tier 2 just for the price of one right there, and I have to say, grouping then, very smart from them, knowing that they were going to be able to outpush their opponents. And Spenu, their reactions have not been good on the map. They are very slow to assign people the lanes, to get people inbound on defense. And that Spenu's now going to be coming in, but they're not really going to be able to do much right here. Remember, they need to make picks with this composition. They can't really siege very effectively.
I mean, both these comps do excellent turret damage, but it's going to be the macro decision-making between the two on who will get the most in their windows. You have to say Anarchy, big advantage there. They showed it already, just outmaneuvering Spenu despite losing out on the objective game in the early game. can they set up the split push they've really comped around? I mean, even 1-3-1 is massively powerful from this team.
Yeah, they have Ixu, they have Mickey for that 1-3-1, and good wave clear as well with the Corki rockets and phosphorus bombs, so they should be able to handle things. Again, they're going to lose their blue one more time. They've been having trouble with this game, but Mickey, who we know is very measured and very skilled when it comes to the split push, we've seen it from his Zed. This is where he has to engage that and really start to turn up the heat.
So here's the question that I have for you, Monty. Look at this Spenu lineup. Lulu, Maokai, Gragas, Nautilus. This is definitely a lineup that can turret dive. Are they actually safe to 1-3-1, or is it going to have to be a 4-1, given just how many engage and dive tools that Spenu have?
Well, that will be the big question right here, is whether Spenu wants to pull the trigger on that.
Mickey, so many go buttons, it seems like a huge risk to engage the 1-3-1, despite the fact that with all the sheens and damage, turrets, as you mentioned, should be folly for this Anarchy lineup.
Yep. Well, Mickey also went for the Abyssal Scepter this game, so I think a little bit more magic resist, and that's going to synergize well with Songyun and Lyra. Meanwhile, Spenu has found an opening, but they're going to lose a mid lane. This is not a good trade for Spenu. They've committed a... Wow.
There could be a 2-for-1 trade, although Anarchy, they're not actually...
TP back up right now for Ixu. They may just want to take this fight. I don't know about this. I think they could push faster, quite frankly.
They're walking through an unwarded jungle as well. There's a lot of pick pressure from Spenu. This is very risky undertaking from Anarchy.
They're going to
go
for
the two turrets.
They have to fight now. Otherwise, this will be in a giant waste. It's going to be a giant waste.
Yeah, this is unfortunately the decision-making mistakes that you see when we're talking about teams in the bottom four play in this 10-team Champions League at the moment. It feels like they could have gotten two turrets in exchange for an inner turret.
Yep.
And when you're talking about the mid and bot lane turret with a split push focused team, seem like it'd be a given. They have three pink wards down around Baron. Gragas in the area, but the Baron pressure from this team is immense.
Yeah, very big. So someone's going to have to face check this. They see Snowflower. There's a hook in. Catches Snowflower up. Box drop. Flash used, but Snowflower is going to just explode. And will they be able to come back? Parallel Convergence going to be zoning out a lot of members from the choke, but the pursuit is still coming in from Spenu. They're so tanky that there's just not enough damage. Songyun fleeing, as is Lyra. Has to use that summoner heal to get Lyra out. Still going to fall to Sivir. And here is Nuclear powering through onto Songyun. Songyun backing off right there, but this is...
Hilarious.
Hilarious, yes.
As Sarsen was doing exactly no damage whatsoever to Ixu. Spenu move on to the Baron. They pick up Lulu in the swap. It's still 9,000 health on the Baron.
Ixu still has teleport here, too. He doesn't have time to go back and get the home guard, but they're going to turn. There is the damage onto Ixu again. Sol will pick him up, but that means no Baron, so mission successful as far as Anarchy is concerned.
And Lulu just got too cute coming to the Baron in the safest, in the riskiest possible manner, not taking a safe route and going around the choke. Went straight through it and got picked off by the two members still up from Anarchy. They might even pick up a turret in mid also. Gonna get a lot of chip damage onto it at minimum. I guess we shouldn't be surprised given the fact that these are two of the bottom teams, but definitely some strategical misplays in the last few minutes.
And they're probably gonna get this dragon as well. Songyun needs to stick around and go for it, actually. They have the dragon live. There's no one on the map right now who can actually contest this. They just gave up the dragon as well with Songyun going back, it would appear.
Wasn't very healthy, and I guess they expected Spenu maybe to
have
some wards around the area.
No, Songyun was fine. He just didn't have mana. He was perfectly healthy, and he had a blade as well, so he would have healed up off the dragon. But they're going to wait for it, and even then, Ixu not going to be using his teleport. They're Sasin taking blue buff. Could be contesting this fourth dragon right now. Man, there were like so many missed opportunities right there. Songyun going back instead of contesting it while Spenu was in base slow after the Baron. Then we see Sasin going after the blue buff while Ixu has TP up, and they could have had a 5v4 around the dragon, but everyone's so tentative and scared, and now all of a sudden Spenu may get a shot at yet another dragon stack.
Feels like both these teams may need to file misconnections articles in the newspaper after this one.
Oh boy, let's go on Craigslist for that.
Could be. Spenu have great control around the dragon. They've done this the whole game. Now, of course, they are spotted out by the Scuttle Crab Vision. Anarchy, they lost their last fight, but they need to opt into a fight around this fourth dragon.
Yeah, they're coming through. There's the Sivir ult. Now, are they going to turn? Righteous Glory's pop. Mickey locked down by the Maokai. Iksu just has no angle on the back line right now. They're trying to focus down Sol. Iksu going to be the target for Spenu. Catch in the back line, but he's going to get blasted by Sangyun. Sangyun finds himself right in front. There goes Lyra, playful trickster on the backside. Mickey actually picks up a kill in all of that. He's going to ult back for some help. Sangyun has to be careful. Sangyun getting critted. Sangyun going down to Sol. And there we go, one for one in the end, but jungler traded for AD carry. That's a trade Spenu will make.
It's an excellent trade for Spenu when it comes to trading up in terms of getting down a damage threat, but of course now they don't have really a chance to pick up Baron, so taking out this inner mid tower is probably going to be the most they're going to get from that team fight victory.
Yeah, so still, small trades being made in Spenu's favor, but they are accumulating over time. Now they're threatening that fifth dragon. Nuclear, absolutely massive.
Wow, 480 carry items and the improved boots. He's, look, it's not like Sonya's any slouch. He has three items, but Nuclear is massive after that very early quadra kill.
Yeah, he is. So he's got to be the one to carry right now, and he's doing a good job. He's playing aggressively. He's getting on top of Sangyun, getting the necessary damage.
This is actually the issue that Hecarim can have against Sivir comps, is that Sivir's unique. When it's, say, Jinx versus Hecarim, Jinx is trying to be cute and poke around the backside. Hecarim can get in there, isolate her out, and try and solo her down. Sivir fights with her tank line. Sivir's right in there with the likes of the Lulu, the Nautilus, the Gragas, and the Maokai. Iksu, multiple fights now, and just hasn't had an angle to try and separate Sivir as a threat. Spenu have a comp that has so much defensive utility, and even with the burst damage of Trinity Force, feels like Iksu's almost a non-factor in fights despite being on a fairly free-farmed Hecarim.
Yeah, although in spite of all this action, Anarchy's still only about 6k down, so, and they're going to catch a little bit back up here with the help of this turret. Nope, not going to quite get it. Intelligently not committing. There as we go. More engaged. Stoneflower knocked up nearly immediately. Iksu wants to get onto Nuclear. Nuclear Wild Growth, though, is just going to kite this one out. No one get down. Fish will hit, but Mickey dies. This is probably going to be it as everyone from Anarchy scattering, but there is Sasin trying to take care of Sangyu, and he will succeed in the end as the splitting will mean that it is nearly an ace and a double kill. Look at Iksu.
Iksu's still trying to play the objective game, but this is just a sign of the times for Anarchy. Ever since the quadricle came around, you're seeing they got finally onto Nuclear. He just had so much lifesteal with the Bloodthirster. Ever since he had extra gold and defensive utility, they don't have backline threat on him, despite having three Sheen items complete, despite having a very high damage comp. And Spenu don't have the most damage, but with Sivir this big, doesn't matter.
Yeah, it really doesn't at this stage. And there's the recall as they take the Baron. They couldn't finish right there.
So watching the replay, just watch. This fight is whether Sivir dies or doesn't die. If she dies, there's just no damage on Spenu's side. Gets chunked down to half, but can kite away outside of vision. Even though there's lots of threats, they're all melee threats, so it can just open up space, and then just starts cutting the front line like butter. They've itemized mostly for damage, not for tanking. 600 damage crits. At this point, with Nuclear alive, they're just picking up kill after kill, and there's nothing Anarchy can do.
Indeed. Well, see Snowflower at the end, valiantly dueling with the Lulu, but I hate to tell you, one of those supports actually has enough items from being in the mid lane to take it out pretty easily.
Even going to pick up the Lich Bane for both turret damage threat and again, even more single target damage threat. And Mickey's big debut onto this Echo, just like Coco's, who played very well himself, just hasn't been enough to make anything happen.
It's actually going to be a Luden's Echo from Sasin, not a Lich Bane.
That's okay. Both probably coming in, potentially.
So, yeah, I mean, this is going to be probably it for Spenu. They looked strong this game. They actually did a great job of controlling the dragon, and we thought maybe Anarchy would be fighting in that power spike, but they really failed to get the adequate pick pressure and engage the team fights properly when it came to using all those. I mean, they're still split pushing with Iksu.
Man, Iksu is annoying. Remember, this is with Baron buff empowered recalls. They still can't open up distance enough. Iksu will pick up this inhibitor, so Anarchy's still getting more than they deserve. He has no mana. Flash is expended, so he's probably going to die eventually, but hollow victory for Spenu.
Yeah, exactly. And Anarchy, in spite of this Baron,
yeah,
you know, one thing that has happened this game and why they couldn't end after that last fight so decisively was the wave, the minion control from Spenu has been horrible. Every time their lanes are pushed up, they haven't been able to actually take that many advantages after their wins.
Okay, but calm down, Monty. Let's think about what Spenu has done. Remember, this game they've had much better ward coverage, especially around objectives, than Anarchy. That's already a big win. We're talking about 10th spot on the ladder against, in terms of the warding game, probably top three when it comes to Anarchy, or at least top five, out warding them. And then the teleports from Sol have been so much better. He's been the one getting into the back line with the home guard into Twisted Advance. Ixu's been the one that hasn't been able to find an angle. So credit to Spenu for doing things we didn't expect. We're going to see a desperate engage, but you can just see the desperation. There's not even a real full-hearted attempt to fight against this Baron buff comp.
No, you can't. And they're trying to poke, but it just does so little damage against this big tank line right now. Mickey got the stun off on the parallel convergence, but that's about it. You have to trade an inhibitor for nothing. And here is Dragon number 5, Baron buff, still up. Nope, falls off right now, actually. That's actually a visual bug.
Dragon 5. There's no defense, offensive wards around the dragon from Anarchy. They're going to DPS it down fast, chasing away Ixu. Fifth dragon's going to be just another massive factor. The ring gauge starts, and there's the fifth dragon.
Yeah, here we go. Ixu just ulting out after seeing them get that fifth sack. Mickey will not be so lucky. CC'd into the ground will Echo be, and now Ixu's back doing Ixu things.
So he used the teleport. They're trying to stop the backs. They've done it so far. Ixu probably can't finish the game, but Anarchy are trying.
You got to it. Oh! He nearly actually got the back onto Sossin right there, barely, and that's going to mean Ixu heading out of this fight, but probably the end of the game coming up as the double kill from Sivir lands. Ixu escapes.
The world's shallowest lantern from Snowfire just couldn't save the poor mustached Bombardier.
You have to respect Ixu and what he's done this game so far. I mean, in spite of Anarchy's loss, he has made this a million times harder for Spenu. Ixu going to come in right now. He's got the last stand of Hecarim going down for a big play from Snowflower, but he's going to get yanked around and into the grave, and that's going to be it. Spenu's actually going to close out their second game win as they grind through the rest of Anarchy, and that's going to be it. Spenu up 1-0 in this series, surprisingly.
But this is at least a Spenu win where you look at the game, and much like we have with Samsung Galaxy over the course of the season, you say, okay, there are things that they were actually putting together both selfishly in terms of team play that actually showed some promise. What you want to see from Spenu is a team that in the back half of the season can be competitive. And look, we're not going to rush to any rash judgments. It is only a win against Anarchy, one of their fellow strugglers. But still, Spenu showing a higher level performance than they have in their preceding, what, 17 games?
Yeah, and Anarchy has to have more jungle presence. You know, this jungle Fizz really wasn't that useful this game. And because they didn't have that force early on to fight, they just couldn't do much around. The dragon gave up every single dragon in this game and never really had that ability to control the tempo except in some very late game split pushes.
What are you saying? Are you saying to me, Monte Cristo, that this hasn't made you a believer of the first round ambiguous Fizz lock-in? Go jungle. And this didn't contribute very much.
Well, Sossin, though, we know is a player who's played a lot of Lulu. I mean, we know Spenu likes to play Juggernaut compositions. They like to play with that Lulu in the mid lane and play around Nuclear. So I can't say that Anarchy should have been too surprised that a very safe pick like Lulu would have come in last. All right, so how are we going to change things up this game?
It's Anarchy on the blue side. Actually ban out the Hecarim themselves, despite being noted Hecarim players. The likes of Ixu played it last game. Maybe it's just one of those situations where they don't want to pass away the Hecarim in the first round of picks on the red side to Spenu. Probably going to see plenty of mid lane bans from Spenu just to keep focusing on Mickey.
I'm really surprised about the Zed ban here when Spenu's on red side. Odds are, I would say, that Anarchy is going to take Victor in the second round of the draft if they can get it, because that is a champion that is relatively safe to pick. And Sossin, he's the only real assassin he's shown a lot of talent on has been LeBlanc. And with the LeBlanc nerfs, I don't think you're quite as worried about that anymore.
Do you ban LeBlanc if you're Spenu? Because it's still, look, it's definitely not as effective. There's less reliable also with just the width on the chain specifically being decreased. But it always has been a champion that was pretty safe to blind pick.
That's true. And Mickey has been there before. Ahri also not necessarily the worst champion to blind pick. Does have a lot of safety.
Was banned last game, of course.
Yeah, was banned last game. But I don't think they're going to let the Ryze through. Gragas banned, so will it be Alistar or The Rod is here. First pick for Anarchy. Just given the way that things have moved so far. Remember, Spetty really prioritizing that Sivir last game, so there's still the possibility that that could come through.
Opens up Alistair, but honestly, Snowflower, it's been the Thresh that's been a priority. And speaking of priorities, out of nowhere, Rek'Sai first picked by Anarchy.
You're going to give away Sivir Alistair here, though. That may be not a very good trade.
Maybe they're playing their own game, Monty. Maybe it's going to be the top lane Rek'Sai that, of course, Samsung Galaxy have been playing. But with so much up, it's a very strange insta-lock from Anarchy.
Yeah, especially we have Evelynn available. And you know Ketch plays Jungle Echo, so he's probably not going to be too worried about having that Rek'Sai taken away.
I guess the only speculation is that he wants to push him away from the early pressure junglers. Gragas is taken away. Rek'Sai very favorable against Evelynn because, of course, has the Tremor Sense to spot her even without the direct vision. No rush to lock in a jungler, but Anarchy, they have the early power spike jungler. Again, we mentioned flexible top lane pick. Strange, strange draft in terms of first pick from Anarchy, though.
I feel like the priority in both our drafts so far today has been pretty wacky. Of course, Corki Fizz locked in the first round of the red side by Anarchy in the last one. Not really picks that stand out as being particularly valuable. Sangyun going to go for the Lucian in this game. Heavy engage. Looking like Anarchy's game this time. And of course, that Lucian can bully out that Sivir early, so they may want to provide a lot of kill pressure. And then Annie goes through, combined with the Rek'Sai, even the Alistar too. There's tons of kill pressure in that bottom side if they want to get it rolling.
When we did see when we saw Sangyun play this Lucian, it was another game where Ku Tigers really got on top of him. It was game two in that series. After just really being bullied around on the Kalista, it was much the same story on Lucian. So we should see where Anarchy do go with their support pick. Do they go for a roam-heavy champion like the likes of Alistar, Annie? Do they just go for the safe Thresh that, of course, is still available? Speaking of safety, Maokai, that pretty much confirms it's going to be jungle Rek'Sai first pick priority from Anarchy.
Very interesting. So going for the lane dominance right here with the Lucian, having some great synergy with the Rek'Sai and the Maokai, that's a lot of ganking pressure on whichever top laner they get. Very easy to chain that CC together. So Spenu has to pick a solo lane now alongside their jungler. What are they going to go with in the end? Evelynn, not that attractive of a prospect into Rek'Sai. Of course, you can see her with the Tremor Sense.
Very obvious rumble pick as they have the Sivir, so they can't even have the speed to disengage off of the Equalizer. Looks like they might actually look for the Fizz. This has definitely been the laning matchup choice. With the Smite Summoner choice by Sol, you have to think top lane Fizz, the Cinderhulk Fizz, by far the most popular this season, is going to be locked in by Spenu.
And that is almost certainly a top lane pickup, but we'll see if Anarchy wants to mix it up. Victor would be very good here. You do have the peel for that. We haven't seen Snowflower play Bard yet, but that's another powerful tool if you want to go with a less mobile mid laner.
What a world it is where Alistar makes it to the fifth round of picks.
I don't understand the priority tonight, Papa Smithy. I really don't. But we could just go for the Mickey special, the Ahri, probably the only impressive Ahri player we've seen this season. Even Faker not looking too great on that champion.
Picked up an MVP on the Ahri in his last performance. Had it banned away in game one. Again, it's a safe blind pick. You can still split a lot of lanes. You have ranged wave clear. It's a very reliable pick. Snowflower hasn't found a lot of success on the Alistar, but just by virtue of it being available, and again, a very strong 2v2 lane with Lucian, it's locked in.
Well, there we go. So Ahri going to be the blind pick here. And, or perhaps not, depending on where that Fizz goes. But Fizz likely just to go into that top lane.
Waiting to see where Spenu goes with their mid lane pick.
I mean, they need some sort of primary engage right now. They have nothing for primary engage at the moment.
They have the sweet insect kick.
Okay, reliable primary engage.
Fair enough.
That's what I qualify as primary engage, something that you can get off in most circumstances to make the team fight go your way. I mean, the Azir engage with the ultimate is a form of engage, but
it's just it's right next to Insect. There's a reason why Azir Sek is one of the pet names for those Azir initiation options. It's a decent lane against Ahri, not ideal because again it's Assassin versus Control Mage matchup. Orianna's would be a similar kind of champion this particular comp, but again, not necessarily the most reliable ball carriers. Karma is the lock-in. Where is the Karma going is the question. Is
it
gonna
Karma's be the mid lane,
yeah,
for sure.
It's have to be Karma mid. Of course, it feels like a lot of the changes were about maybe moving some power away from Karma mid. Still going to be a lot of utility. Still going to be a super fast team comp between Nuclear and the On the Hunt and, of course, the Mantred E. But this is a surprising pick. Very strong laner, though.
So basically, what Spenu is doing is they are just rebuilding their composition from last game, except without the Lulu. This is the next best thing to Lulu in terms of getting team-wide speed down to make the picks and to pile on through that they had in the last game. So this is kind of a Band-Aid fix. I don't think it's as good as the Lulu, but we'll see how it works.
So, I mean, in a lot of ways, I think you're correct, Monte Cristo, of course. Very good wave clear, even at level one, coming through from Karma. Strong laner, safe laner. I guess the big difference to me between Karma and Lulu is that Karma's damage, her only damaging spell, the Q, is blocked by tanks. It's blocked by the first target. So you don't have any real backline damage threats, and even the auto attacks aren't quite as formidable. So doesn't really necessarily plug and play quite as well.
Right. And the difference is you have the team-wide speed up instead of just the whimsy going through. You still have that really big shield. I mean, Karma's base shield is so, so big, but the team-wide speed up doubling up on that Karma and the Sivir. We're going to get into game two, guys. Between Anarchy and Spenu, a very interesting mid lane Karma appearing. Let's see if it works.
There we go, Monte Cristo. Finally, the Anarchy fans in full voice. And their team desperately needs them. They're 1-0 down against Spenu.
Yeah, this is a situation that is rather unpleasant if you're Anarchy, considering that Spenu has yet to put a win on the board in a best of three, but they're one game away right now. You can see even after their win, the Spenu fans, or the Spenu players, just looking very, very focused. Not a lot of smiles. They just want to close this one out and get that W on the board.
Super interesting item start by Sol. Doran Blade on the Fizz. Usually we see a far higher regen start. Maybe with the evolution of these jungle follows where you don't need to solo a camp, maybe just the extra damage to the camp will be enough to really get going as this top lane Fizz.
Well, let's keep some eyes here on how this is going to work. So looks like lane swap is going to be coming in from Anarchy. I'm pretty sure they don't want that lane swap, considering they picked the Lucian very intentionally into the Sivir. They may be trying to call, but they're not going to get what they want here.
I might actually disagree with you, just because they're opting into a 2v1 onto a Fizz that really doesn't have any options farming under turret. Maokai, as we always say, has excellent range farming despite being a melee champion and good sustain. So they don't quite get the 2v2 lane. They isolate the mid. Maybe isolating the Karma versus Ahri might actually be a risk for them, but in terms of what they're holding down, and in this case it's the solo lane Fizz, I do like the lane swap.
Well, also, you know, Spenu is that newer team. Maybe they're not so comfortable in a lane swap situation. Snowflower is going in for a little bit of harassment right here, but it's just not going to be effective. Still pretty high HP from Spenu. Catch going to take some damage, but Snowflower taking quite a few hits right now.
Snowflower just trying to get aggro onto Catch, who just has to stay on the buff, couldn't peel away and try and kill Alistar, even though he was getting super low, able to walk away. So they delayed the jungle follow regardless.
They did indeed, but Lyra already moving through. He's not going to face the same trouble with Ixu as Secret looks for some harassment. Just gets the ward down, though. And yeah, that's the thing. This top lane Fizz is punishable due to low wave clear, even though they have wave clear in the form of Karma and Sivir. So we'll see if they want to go for that early on. They could also, the theory too is you can give that blue buff over to Maokai and have him be much more effective in a 1v2. They're not going to do that this game.
And low wave clear is generous when we're talking about top lane Fizz, because of course you can't max the playful tricks to first. You're maxing the Seastone Trident, the W, It is very fiercely single target. It's like a lot of chip damage from a lane bully like Lucian. The last time I actually saw top lane Fizz is on the weekend. It was coming through from Flandrian, given some of his crazy item builds. Maybe we shouldn't put too much faith in, but he actually went Magus with the smite and went for an AP Fizz build, which, look, his AP
he did that
Echo
with
definitely
Echo
didn't work out, but the Fizz at least has a little bit more promise when it comes to wave clear. With the Dawnblade start, still can't really see that from Sol.
No, highly problematic. Well, where is Sol going to go right now?
He chooses top.
He's got TP into the top side. Rek'Sai's there. If he walks into that wave, he could be in big trouble. And there we go. Hook lands onto Ixu in the bottom side. They get some damage, but not a whole lot else. Now, they are going to see the Rek'Sai in top lane. Sol spotted him out when going to ward. And so the pings continue, but this Fizz has to be very careful. Did buy two wards, does get them in the river and in the tri brush.
Was I mistaken, or did Fizz have blue buff? The only thing I can confirm is level 3, so it does have two different movement abilities to be able to get away from a gank. So it's quite slippery, even just at level 3. Might have even picked up the blue buff, but wasn't clear from a couple of moments ago.
Yeah, it was a very quick movement up there. I mean, Lee Sin doesn't have it, it looks like, so. Definitely could have been handed over. Lee Sin not going to make that much use of a blue buff early on.
It's a very high base cooldown on Playful Tricks. I believe it's at 15 seconds or more, so of course 10% will be relevant, but you don't really spam out your spells as Fizz until you get short enough cooldowns, and when you're not maxing Playful Trickster, that doesn't really come until level 12, level 13. So look, it's experience that's quite effective, and Lee Sin doesn't need it to complete his jungle, so still, probably not a bad pass over by Spennett.
All right, well, Ixu's going to be a little bit behind in levels thanks to the 1v1 for the top laner in that side, and he's also having a bit of trouble in terms of his CSing. They're slowly catching up, but with the wave pushing back towards Sol, he will have a much safer time CSing under that turret to make a difference. Hook goes on to Ixu, lots of damage, but here comes Lyra. Actually, Secret bounced out, and Secret has nowhere to go. Aggressive at the wrong time, and that's why it's so risky to play aggressively when you don't know where the enemy jungler is. They had no wards to see that Lyra was incoming.
And Snowfall just able to punt him 650 units towards his oncoming jungler. Very smart move. Now Nuclear ends up getting denied. It's a very nice early game from Anakin. Just smart moves from their jungler, in particular Lyra. He's the one we kind of have to single out. Almost a non-factor on jungle Fizz in game one. Already getting a kill involvement in the first 5 minutes in game two.
Well, we have to say that was very unusual for Lyra as a player just because he has been a big factor for this team. In fact, you look at the two big stars of Anarchy, the biggest playmakers have been Mickey and Lyra. So to see him on that Fizz and not doing much at all for that last game was not really in his character.
Snowfire doing an excellent job of freezing this wave and not letting it hit turret. Of course, Nuclear has a lot of wave clear, so maybe only delaying the inevitable, but still smart use of the headbutt regardless. And Ixu gets there before it hits turret, so nice little laning mechanics coming through. I guess one thing I'm interested in Monte Cristo, one thing I want to know the answer to is, where does the second max come through from Sarsen? Because when we've seen Gorilla play this support Karma, Q-Max, you know, for lane control, I think, is always going to be a given. We've seen W-Max for the extra root duration come through. You mentioned the high base health on the shield, over 400, 430 or so, if you max it second. I can still see arguments for W, but regardless, you're going to get a lot more experience on mid lane Karma than bot lane.
I think that E-Max is so valuable, though, because her mantra at E is, I'm pretty sure, the biggest shield in the game at 400? Plus?
I think 430 was the number I just said. It's around there.
Yeah. We were looking that up last week, I know. And it is just an absolutely massive shield. And with some AP, it's going to be even bigger.
But you have to remember, you know, very quick access to a 3.25 second point and click hard CC in the root from the W has to be respected as well. So we'll definitely keep our eyes on where Sarsen's going with the max. We remain to be convinced that Karma can be the soul lane threat, but given that it's purely utility, can it just be a backup Lulu?
This will be a very interesting backup Lulu, I have to say. No other team has tried to use the Karma as a backup Lulu, but Spenu found a way to effectively run the same comp again. And, you know, I have to respect the draft from Spenu here, just because They won with the comp the last time. They looked better on it than they have previously. They looked competent on it. And as a new team, it looks like they finally found something that may work for them. And the solution is, if the Lulu is bad, well, we can still run it with just a slightly different pick in the mid lane that accomplishes the same thing. So instead of focusing on trying to play multiple strategies, they're just trying to play the same strategies with as many different champions as they can.
And one of the things I asked you off-air was, when it comes to this Spenu lineup, what's their real point of optimism? Because you never want a team that's just dead last, and you're like, okay, it's another 2-0, why are we even watching this game? Just the fact that you verbalize that point, Monty, let's think of a team that's right down the bottom with them and Samsung. We think of Samsung more optimistically. They've been definitely guilty of bringing out excellent strategies in game one, having a key champion banned, and then being like, I guess we just sort of run the same thing. In this case, Spenu has had the target champion banned, but actually innovated a backup strategy that fits the same role and doesn't just give them the remnants of the previous comp. It's actually a very smart, astute adjustment. So it's good to see that from Spenu. It's something more than some of their contemporaries can do. Soul's under a lot of risk, but Ari's already backed away, so probably not going to be too much in the end.
Okay, well, they're going to see this Rek'Sai up in the top side, and that's going to prompt the Dragon. I mean, this looks like very similar to last game where Lyra wanted to gank that top side and used it to give up a Dragon. He's just not going to get there in time, even with the Void Run. Oh, he stole it! Sogyut comes in with the culling and actually takes it off the reset. Mickey's there, dash into the back of the pit. Sogyut not going to go down from the Ignite. And now everyone piling into the pit. Soul's trying to get the damage down. Mickey continues to fire from the outside. They're focusing down. Sogyut comes back for some more damage. Still three people in the pit. Mickey has to flash out, but he's going to get some return damage on that. Mickey, why would you stay?
Why would you stay is the question. Why wouldn't you finish the Dragon if you're Spenu? They tried not to look at the explosion as they backed away, Monte Cristo. Fell down to 9 health, then re-leashed, didn't pick up the objective, and lose the kill trade. So, real head scratcher from Spenu. And Anarchy, undeservedly, pick up the advantage early in this game.
Wow. That culling from Sogyut, though, for the steal was pretty hilarious.
The 20 damage a bullet culling.
Wow. Well.
So watch this replay. So they just walk away, Sivir. Even Catch loses interest. Thinks it's dead. It's not. And you're watching the culling. Smart move from Matt. It was honestly going to be Snowfire or Sogyut. They're the only ones that had cooldowns for damage. And then obviously at this point, everyone's just all over because Spenu was already backing away in different directions. They pick up the first kill. And just a comedy of errors from Spenu.
Yeah, I mean, even from Anarchy right here, sure, they do a good job of cleaning up these kills. I especially like Sogyut coming back in to get some damage down. But look how long they wait here. I mean, Nuclear's still full HP. You can't make this play. And you especially can't make this play right here, Mickey. You know, I love your confidence, but just get out. You already won.
And even if he had complete information and knew that that area wasn't warded, there's still always the risk that the skill shot hits from Lee Sin. It just wasn't a percentage play. And maybe we shouldn't be surprised that in a battle of the bottom four teams, percentage plays have been pretty much abandoned.
Yeah. Well, Anarchy, in spite of the errors, still comes out with the win in that team fight off of a very ridiculous Dragon Leash.
Everyone just decided to leave. Everyone had somewhere better to be. Sivir was like, I'm out of here. There's some creeps to go and clear. Oh, dear.
Lyra now going to take up a little bit of counter jungling.
And now there's going to be frustration on the side of Spenu. And what better play from Lyra on a strong skirmishing jungle? Just get in the enemy jungle, get in their face. They've got excellent ward coverage around this blue buff area and realistically might be contesting the blue buff we expect to spawn in a few seconds.
Seems like it. Anarchy gave up a lot of blue buffs last game and now trying to be better around that objective. You notice there's a big vision difference for Anarchy between this game and last game. Now they want to go for the dive. They have the Alistar at level 6. There's the dive coming in. Pops the ult immediately. Mickey's there. This is where everyone dies on Spenu. Can they even get a kill in response? Sogyut on the cleanup crew for a double.
And Snowflower excellently tanking out the turret. In fact, in general, the turret aggro juggling was wonderful from Anarchy. This is the Anarchy we expected to see in game one. It took us a very lame game from them in terms of just really rolling over and dying when it came to dragons, when it came to kills, but really getting it together in game two.
Well, I'm just... This warding is so much more typical of what we've seen from Anarchy than what we saw at game one, where they were just very lazy about their vision control when they normally just populate the map with wards. I mean, we've seen them with five pinks on the map by 15 minutes before against top teams, and it's very uncharacteristic of them. So they seem to be pulling themselves up by their bootstraps now and starting to fix some of the errors they made in game one.
I can only speculate that in game one, they were so focused on those item times. We noticed Lich Bane double Trinity Force at about 15 minutes. Maybe they were just so focusing on early damage, you know, saying, okay, can't afford the consumables this game, no green wards like they typically do. Because this is a team who, even before Sightstone, everyone's buying two, three wards, whereas the mid laner, the jungler, etc. They spent all that gold on damage, didn't really parlay that into an advantage, and then there was pink wards that were honestly sticking around Dragon for 20, 30 minutes the previous game. This game, back to the earlier power specs, back to the likes of Maokai, who can just build the Catalyst and throw in wards whenever possible, and a much more typical game from Anarchy.
Yeah, they keep on pushing through there. They're trying to punish just by proxy farming right now, denying nuclear as much as they can, making that Avarice Blade look like a foolish investment. And they're getting their way. Secret and Nuclear have no way to make plays. Meanwhile, Catch is going to go to the opposite side of the map, but with the blue buff already taken away, I mean, this is Sasan gets a blue, but there's just much more advantage to the movement on the map that we've seen from Anarchy so far. Sangyin just going to pop out and finish off this turret, looks like.
And this is definitely an early game where both the kills, the turrets, and even the dragon, maybe crucially the dragon, because honestly that was the big turning point of the game, is going for Anarchy. And it was the same story for Spenu last game, and roles reverse here.
Yep. And there we go. There's the five pink wards on the map at 15 minutes.
It's actually late by their standards. They're excellent at maintaining these smart timings. They just have so much safety around the map. Early Power Sprite jungler in terms of the Lee Sin, who's going the warrior enchant. There's just no lanes to gank because they just don't have pressure anywhere.
Yes. Excellent setup on the dragon right now. And look at this timing. So Sangyun left the turret up, and the wave pushed back after the proxy farming. And look at this, 15 seconds before Dragon, that's when the turret goes down, that's when they push the lane forward, and it's just a total blackout for Spenu around this Dragon. The pink wards have been set up so far in advance. You could argue that maybe this is overkill, four pink wards in the river. That's a very hefty investment in terms of team-wide gold.
Honestly though, Monty, this is when you get scolded by your school teacher after game one, that it's like, look, what were you doing? You know your strengths, you don't get anything done, and you just play as optimally around the vision game as possible, because they completely let it go last game.
Yeah, I mean, you know you've got a lot of wards when even I'm questioning how many wards you have.
Can be no ambiguity for Anarchy when it comes to this second dragon. Even Home Guards was picked up. Mickey was a bit cute with his back time. He only really got the recall through 8 seconds before the dragon, but had the gold to fit in the Home Guard. So got the big shot, finished the Merlin Omicron, so probably still worth it. Spenu's definitely not playing around this dragon, but Anarchy haven't started off despite having just picture-perfect warding.
Yep. Well, they're going to go for it right now. They get the waves in the place where they're going to be comfortable. Ixu has the teleport. He's got to be careful. Some shenanigans afoot up in the top side from Spenu, because they're just so afraid of walking into the darkness in the river right now. And Ixu has his own little pink ward right there. And you know what? I don't know if they could see anybody when that dragon buff was taken. They may not actually have a very good timer on that.
That's unique, of course, with the change to dragon. It's almost always quicker. Someone's usually in a lane or in a ward. That would be actually a unique interaction, and maybe that means the timer for the third dragon, the all-crucial third dragon, may be slightly astray for Spenu.
I'm not sure. I was looking at the top lane. I'm not sure if Mickey was actually back in mid by the time it died, but it would be a little bit close. You're obviously going to have some sort of vague idea, but it may not be precise. So, Sangyun now walks into top. He's got that Infinity Edge already, and Sasan taking some damage. Snowflower there. Soul getting knocked around. Skirmisher smite onto Sangyun. Snowflower, the designated fish tanker. And there you go. Finisher from Lyra.
Had to use the flash. Also caught in the transition is Catch. don't have quite enough damage to take him down, but Anarchy completely dictating the pace of game two.
Well, Soul just can't do anything right now. He's got Cinderhulk into Trinity Force. Well, I hate to say it, that's not going to help you against Songyun's Infinity Edge.
So if a rabbit's foot is the Lucky Charm, what could the equivalent be for the Fizz Locker?
I don't know. Is this a joke? Is there a punchline coming off of Smithy?
I'm just asking a question for what's unlucky, Monte Cristo.
Okay.
Silver Ultimates pop. Snowfar's looking for an angle for the Pulverize. Doesn't quite get it. It's actually falling very low in an Ignite. Running on re-engaged by Soul. They really want to get this first kill on the backline onto Snowfar. He's actually going to survive. At least Lucian's completely knocked away from his team, and no kills come through despite the commitment by Spenu.
Now, Spenu, they wanted to go in right there. They tried to make something work. They know they're in a desperate situation, but even though they chunked out some of the members of Anarchy, there's just no follow-up in any reasonable regard. Look at the side wave control again. This is something that Spenu had issues with last game in spite of their win. They just can't get pressure on the map, and now they just have to break apart. Can't take the mid turret, can't take any outer turret, and that gives Anarchy a whole hell of a lot of time to clear out the jungle and recall.
Yeah, just unfortunately Spenu not being able to force anything out of Anarchy. Anarchy are dictating the pace, they're dictating the dragon control. It shouldn't have been this way, it should have been first dragon to Spenu, but even a mistake around that objective moved what would have been a very hollow early game victory in terms of the first dragon completely away, and now things are stacking up, and just like Anarchy, who were looking at an early third dragon, early fourth dragon from Spenu last game, again, it's completely reversed this game.
Yeah, it is. Well, Anarchy moving in, they're going to try and see what they can do to catch, just getting a small amount of damage before the Karma Shield comes through.
Karma Shield's already very potent, but the damage is certainly not there from Nuclear, and that's going to be the big difference. Even if he lives slightly longer, he doesn't have the damage to back it up. And when you run these one-threat comps, you can argue that Soul might be a backup threat, but with Cinderhulk and Ashin not going to be in too much damage, you live and die based on the fact that Sivir can put out damage.
Yeah, and also, I mean, just the item disparity. Two core items already done, zero for Spenu so far. And a lot of that is that 50 CS difference from Songyun. Remember how much work he did zoning Sivir off the turret with the proxy farming in the bottom wave. And that's exactly the benefit that Anarchy's vision control had, because it made it so unsafe for Nuclear to even walk up to his tier one tower that he didn't really have a choice besides to lose a ton of CS straight into the bottom tower.
See, the charm does hit into Karma, but very tanky with the shield. It's the same pressure, of course, that Snowfire himself felt against Kutai. It's the same sort of pressure that Gorilla was able to put down in the bottom lane with Prey. So, reminiscent of that, Anarchy, they're looking for an initiation. Snowflower hasn't got Flash available, but look at this poke damage from Songyun.
Yeah, that early shiv, combined with the Infinity Edge, equaling some massive damage early in this game, and
21 minutes, no Infinity Edge from Sivir.
That is a dire situation. That Avarice Blade just hasn't been able to do a lot of work with the low amount of farm Sivir has gotten since picking up that item. So they're gonna take the blue buff. They could transition immediately into the bottom side right now. They have the wave prepped. That's what they're gonna do eventually, as soon as Mickey makes his way over for the blue buff.
Picks up the blue. Dragon's a minute 20, but this, you know, decent red ward coming through from Spenu. The pink wards have been slightly cleared out. Definitely not five on the map at the moment, but a couple in the inventories. Mickey's looking for a pick on to catch, but it won't come together.
Yeah, difficult to make that go through against the Lee Sin. Maybe blowing that spirit rush a little bit early, but he should have it up by the time the next dragon rolls around and any fight starts to appear. So Ixu is clearing out the top side, and they'll move on from there. So it's about time we see Anarchy back off, start to set up their wards again, get control of that dragon, and slowly ride this out with the large lead that they've accrued in the first 22 minutes of this game.
Really don't agree with Soul so far behind. You know, decent CS, but you know, no real kill involvement, just struggling. Going for a Trinity Force build in a game like this where the team has so little pressure. It's not like Civ has been able to wave clear and draw pressure in other lanes. So going for the Cinderhulk Trinity Force build, it's going to be very long time into this game, and the burst damage, is that really going to be a big tool for them with the power spikes Anarchy have already hit?
Well, damned if you do, damned if you don't. You don't have damage if you don't have, because of Sivir's delay on our build.
Yeah, that's fair.
And If you have, pick coming in. Not sure about that. Mickey has the Spirit Rush already.
Ultimate popped as well. Sung is completely out of position. No defense for him whatsoever, so it's going to be an easy kill. They can choose who they give to, although Maokai's here. It's still 4v3. They're going to win the engage, though. Mickey picks up one, going to pick up another one, and Sung Yoon survives.
Wow, Sung Yoon right there. The fadeaway culling actually doing work. And what a good teleport from Iksu to get the necessary pressure. Mickey going to get hit by the fish. Mickey going to go down after his double. And it doesn't look like they're going to be able to finish off the Fizz in the end. They may want to turn onto this dragon now, going for the tier two. A little bit ambitious without any wave clear there.
But Sung Yoon survived despite what? On the hunt and the shoot and the speed being put out from Karma. They got there so much faster, but they didn't have the damage to actually take him down. Rode him off too early. It's going to be the third crucial dragon coming through from Anarchy. They don't walk away from it in that situation. Soul can't pick up the seal. Looks for a kill on the backside, but it's going to be difficult for the Fizz.
Wow. Really don't know about that teleport from Soul. That was a big cooldown that they could have used in a more meaningful capacity. They didn't have the follow-up right there. Let's take a look at Sanyu right here, who definitely should not be there at the moment. He is going to flash out. There's the Sonic Wave hitting him. Eats a Boomerang Blade, and look at that, just barely surviving thanks to Iksu's prompt arrival with the TP.
Just a sliver of health, below 100 health, but that's all that matters. Seeing an engage, actually a turret dive coming through from Catch. He dies himself. We're going to see Maokai keep going. Mickey uses the charm, hits it onto Sars. It's so much burst damage from Lucian. Kills pile up for Anarchy.
And right there, Secret goes down for the double. They could just plow through the mid lane. They could take the Baron right now. Choices abound for Anarchy.
I mean, look at the minion wave in top. I know we talk about minion waves a lot, but there's such a huge wave that needs to be dealt with that getting to this Baron is going to be difficult.
Yes, it is. Well, nice catch there in the mid. And Catch actually dove that and tried to insect Mickey, but Mickey just spirit rushed and got kicked the wrong direction. So was able just to spirit rush right back in and solidify that kill. So Catch, very ambitious on the fact that he was going to catch out and insect an Ahri.
I mean, a couple minutes before, we noticed Ahri trying to spirit rush over the wall to get a catch onto Lee Sin. It feels like the mobility not being respected on either side. As with the Baron buff, minions still easy to do a lot of tower damage. Secret's probably gotten too cute, gets killed immediately, and there might be more for Anarchy.
Trying to disengage right now. Iksu gets his Twisted Advanced Spell Shield. Sasan's still in the front line, though, and just gets wrecked by the Focus Fire. Catch, a little bit of a combo onto him, takes a bit of damage, but maybe a little bit too forward by Snowflower right there. There just wasn't the damage to follow up on Catch, so the CC goes a little bit wasted and costs him his life.
Cost of the early game is a 10,000 gold lead for Anarchy. They're definitely playing the sort of League of Legends we expected for them in game one and certainly didn't get. They're able to go back with the Baron empowered recalls. And Sung Yoon's definitely having the sort of item lead that Nuclear was able to put together in game one. Now three items, including the Bloodthirster. So even being a 500 range AD carry, lots of relative safety in these fights.
Yeah, but they lost one of their Baron buffs right now. They haven't been able to put down a lot of pressure with that since they did get overextended a little bit into the turret radius. They're going to try and focus down the rest of these outers. Fortunately, again, the minion waves really moving in their favor. Soul just going to recall, looks like. Sauce in there to clear out the waves. They want to get the blue buff first. I mean, this is kind of just delaying their pressure.
Talked about the late power spike on the Infinity Edge at 21 minutes. Soul doesn't have Trinity Force, but he does have Mickey, an easy option to take out. But Mickey just skips past him and engages onto the back line. Sarsen's still alive. Mickey's taken so much damage. Hasn't died himself either. Surprisingly, no one's died. Secret's the first one to fall, and Mickey gets out.
Mickey gets out with the help of the shield from Alistair right there. Face of the Mountain doing some work to keep him alive. So, catch.
Heal was used from Nuclear to keep him alive. This is a crazy game. Anarchy definitely not looking to delay and prop things. Actually takes a lot of auto attacks. Heal has to be used as well. Soul looks to re-engage. So many low health bars, but the fight's not over.
What a sloppy siege from Anarchy right here. I mean, dashing in on Lucian into Nuclear's face when, you know, I know you've got more items, buddy, but you're still at 50% HP, you can't be too confident. And so this Baron really just not being utilized effectively. by Anarchy. They've gotten a couple towers, but they probably should have broken the base by now.
Finally see that it was the Shield Max second from Karma. Catch has caught himself, but is there enough damage from early? It looks like the answer is no. Gonna see Catch get in and get cute, but able to tunnel away, and Lyra will survive.
Baron buff still gonna be up here, or not anymore, just fell off, looks like. So here we go. Back up the mid lane. Now they don't have those Baroned up minions to do work. Sangyun has opted to get a Bloodthirster to help out with the poke, and the fact that there's really no tankiness on Spenu, so why get a Last Whisper this early? Finally, they break the base.
Maokai on the minimap actually threw a sapling to stop at the last second Nuclear's recoil. Of course, he's the only real wave clear next to Karma, who's been caught every time he's tried to walk up to a wave. So it's very important they start the recoil. They finally break the base. Definitely more of the siege, but Spenu are always looking for an angle to initiate, despite being 13,000 gold behind.
They don't. Oh, wow. Actually, just catching out. Catch and Sasin immediately with a combo. Double kill for Sangyun. And they're just going to keep moving through this base. Finally, look like they'll be able to get an inhibitor after Mickey split pushed a wave right up to that top lane inhib.
And Mickey's Ahri reputation is only enhanced by a game like this. We've seen Sarsen caught out multiple times with the charm. Once again, another solo kill onto a turret to open up the objective. This will be the third inhibitor turret that Anarchy will be able to take down. And almost mathematical, they'll win from here.
Yeah, moving forward. Sangyun again with the aggressive initiation. He's going to dodge the fish, though, with the help of that QSS. Soul dives to the back line. He goes down. And that's going to be probably the close to the end of this game. Anarchy may decide to back off, but they're gonna go for the gamble.
They're going to go for the finish. This is the Anarchy we know and love. They keep going, but they get the pick onto Seeker with another charm coming through from Mickey. It's going to be at least one Nexus turret coming down. And in a 5v3 scenario, this should be the game.
Pushing forward, getting that last Nexus turret. Now they're going to focus on the Nexus itself. They take out Snowflower, but there's just not enough. Can they pad their stats in the meantime? Catch once to get a hit onto Anarchy. He's not going to quite make it into the back line. A double kill for Sivir. But Iksu and Sangyun have enough damage to take out the Nexus, and that'll even us up 1-1 this afternoon.
Anarchy squares the ledger with a win in game two. Spenu in game one almost got split pushed by the Hecarim in game two. Anarchy, they could have sieged, but they just thought they'd just try out three or four dives. A couple of them didn't come off. Finally, the last one did. They were 10,000 gold ahead, so they were with enough of an advantage to try out something cute. But definitely bottom of the table action on display here, Monte Cristo.
No doubt. Bloody game. Not with the best strategy, but in the end, this time Anarchy, in spite of that ridiculous dragon fight early on, they got the first dragon this time. They didn't fall behind in objectives like they did last time, and they were able to get the wards down necessary to close.
And I think it's another game that reminds us why we do see Ahri bans come in against Mintu and just do that amazing ward control around those important objectives, or if Spenu can find a way to ape their game one comp, have to feel like Lulu once again going to be a target ban against Sarsen.
So, Anarchy going to be on the blue side for a second consecutive game. They are going to ban Azir, which was actually their red side ban in game one. They switched it up for the Hecarim, Lulu, and Gragas on blue side in the last game, as you could see on our screen. So maybe a bit of a different strategy. Again, the Zed for Spenu.
And there's the Lulu ban I was alluding to. I think it's smart. Karma fit in a lot of ways, but just doesn't have the same sort of pressure and doesn't have the backline damage threat that Lulu can have in the late game.
So Zed, Kalista, and Ryze were the bans from red side Spenu last round. So looks like Anarchy wants to leave up the Hecarim this time.
Didn't ban. That was their first ban on blue side last game. Spenu probably have to ban away the Ryze. We haven't seen it patch 5.11. Crucially, no significant Ryze changes, so Ryze still at that first pick status in competitive play. It does leave open the Hecarim. Will Iksu be confident just to blind pick the Hecarim like we might see in the next series from Duke on Najin? Or will it just be something that comes through? I guess we'll find the answer soon as Ryze is our last ban.
So, Alistar, Sivir, or Rek'Sai? Last game, we had Rek'Sai go first. Sivir and Nautilus go in the first round of the draft for Spenu. That Alistair falling all the way to last pick for Anarchy, and they're just going to go with the same thing. I mean, Lyra did do a lot of work on the lanes early with the Rek'Sai.
Ban Gragas, lock in Rek'Sai. They tried to match the early power spike ganking jungler with Lee Sin, but Catch unfortunately reverted to some of his previous season form. Just couldn't get anything done on that Lee Sin whatsoever. It leaves open the Sivir, which of course is still a very popular first round pick. But where does Spenu want to go? Because I don't think recreating this Jhin Air or SKT pick comp for a third time is probably going to be in their advantage.
No, I really agree with you on that front, but I think you want to take the Sivir and Nautilus here, or Sivir and Alistair rather, because that's a combination they should have picked last game, but went for the Nautilus instead. And you know, they really paid for it. The Alistair pick enables Mickey's roaming and tower diving so much that you have to get rid of it.
Yeah, it felt like two mistakes really took the game away. First, of course, not finishing that dragon, then not taking the Alistair led to that easy turret dive after they'd already given away a free objective. And it only looked up there from Anarchy.
So, Maokai and Lucian, same draft identically if they lock in these picks as to what we saw last game in terms of the order as well, not only the champions themselves, and that's what they're going to do. They feel very confident, and why wouldn't they?
And it's just, look, moving away from the Fizz jungle, moving to more standard lanes, opened up their vision game. It's felt like That vision game loss in game one was a byproduct of what was a very wonky draft coming through with just some weird corner of the meta picks. So moving standard, we're going to expect a very standard playstyle, both in terms of warding and laning from Anarchy this game, wherever the draft goes from here. Because as you mentioned, so far identical.
Yep. They're going to have to mix it up, though, because they're not going to get the Alistair. Can still get the Ahri, however, and of course, Snowflower on that Thresh is no slouch. Catch may try an alternative in that Nidalee as an early game jungler, but this is going to drastically change Spenu's composition. They're going to want to be kiting with the Sivir instead of engaging, generally speaking. Now, we've seen Jhin Air run similar compositions in their last magic. Oh, they're doing it.
Wow, so they're returning to the Karma. Maybe as one of these lower ranked teams, they came in one strong strategy. They had that kind of extra string to the bow and the Karma as the variant pick to the Lulu. Didn't get a lot done last game. It opens up effectively the same draft. Okay, Annie's not Alistair, but honestly, similar initiation threat from support.
Also, the fact that you can tank out the turret with Tibbers as you begin a dive as well does eliminate a lot of that turret damage, so they can execute nearly exactly the same thing. And you know, this is so funny because in that CJ Najin game, we saw virtually the same comps come out for both sides twice in a row. And you know what? It went both ways. First game, CJ won. Second game, we saw Najin take it home, but it looks like just more of the same, except this time Spenu, they've got an insane ability to kite right here.
All Spenu can really put together is the last pick is the top laner. Do you go for the Hecarim that's made it through the draft for some sort of backline threat onto the Lucian, maybe to tie him up and try and deal with Ahri in the front line? Do you just go for a Rumble for an early power spike? There's a lot of options. Okay, we're going different here, Monte Cristo.
Yep. Yeah, I think that this is much better when you have the Nidalee pick, the Varus Nidalee combination, and we're going to see a top lane Karma this game. So this is the third position Karma has been played in here in Korea this season.
And I guess we shouldn't be surprised. Top lane Lulu, we've already said that Karma seems to be a backup Lulu. Again, going to be risky to lane in the top lane. And the one thing I can tell you is that, of course, we saw a lot of success for Jhin Air against CJ running Nidalee Maokai twice because they, of course, Twisted Advance is a targeted gap closer. You hit the spear. Excellent gank pressure. You certainly can't gank for Karma in the same manner. Of course, with the W, though, you could maybe even just look to try and engineer a similar situation, but much easier to juke into minions and make it harder to hit that skill shot.
And maybe you can gank mid lane after 6 if Sossin can land a Chain of Corruption, but that is pretty optimistic and dependent on that skill shot, especially since Ahri will be able to dodge out of it very easily. So not a lot of options for Catcher. He may just have to farm up early or try and affect some counter ganking if Lyra comes into the top side, which may be pushed up as a result of empowered Qs burning the wave. I'm very interested to see how Catch plays this in terms of his pathing and his reaction, and whether Lyra is going to be able to get those kills, because he has kill pressure in every single lane.
There could be a wave clear advantage in 3 lanes for Sonic Boom, so maybe that will empower Nidalee to get Q, but we'll have to wait and see.
Anarchy fans showing up after that game one.
And as we draw into the early afternoon, 2 p.m. local time, finally the fans have woken up and are ready for what is a very important third game. This is the last game, or towards the last game, these two teams will play as we move into the back end of the season. It'd be a massive victory for Spender to pick up, but this draft they put together, it's either really going to work or it's going to come completely unglued.
Yeah, that's the thing, is that you're looking at a very execution-heavy kiting composition with a lot of siege, a lot of poke, and it's very dependent on hitting particular item power spikes because otherwise you're going to tail off. And Anarchy has plenty of engage. They have Maokai, they have Annie, they have Ahri moving forward with Charm. It's going to be really, really hard, even with all this speed, for Spenu to avoid the many, many dangerous forms of engage that Anarchy has. And, you know, just as a team, if I was looking at Jhin Air playing this composition, I'd be like, Jhin Air is probably one of the best teams to play a composition like Spenu, and I would have a lot of faith. Spenu has not really shown a skill in playing kite comps. Remember the last poke comp they tried to run against KT where they had Jace Corki? Mm-hmm. They didn't get a single kill. Not one in the game. So that makes me worried.
That's an ominous omen, Monte Cristo, but you said this comp had a lot of item timings to hit from Spenu. It's also like just macro or like team movement things, because if you don't get that outer ring of turrets down early before Vision can come down, remember, Anarchy are an excellent warding team. The teleport home guard flanks from Maokai. He has so many options when it comes to engage that if he just can't open up a big advantage of Sol, almost dies to the Raptor camp. Again, we have to really wait till 20, 25 minutes, take stock of where Spenu are at, and then we can kind of work out what's happening from there.
Okay, Sol is not level 2. Ixu was just donated the blue buff. So this is going to be to counteract Sol's pressure in the top side, considering he will have that pushing advantage with the empowered Q early on. So they just want to match pressure for pressure right here. Make sure Ixu can keep relatively far forward in the laning phase and not get chipped too badly early on. And you know what? I think this is smart. You have to be so worried about tower chip if you're Anarchy right here, because if you get your towers chipped so badly and then Sol and the rest of Spenu start to group in the mid game, it's so easy to take those turrets just off one wave. So this is actually going to do a lot.
It also releases pressure in terms of the jungle matchup, Monte Cristo, because Karma definitely has more ranged farming or pushing options than Maokai in a lot of situations. As you mentioned, the buff going to equalize that a bit. Varus, he might take to level 7, but will start to outpush Ahri as Lyra and Catch steal away from Lyra. But Sivir in the bottom lane again has pushing advantage. If you're pushing up in three lanes, that opens up nearly play. So aggressive. Speaking of aggression, we see the Pulverize onto Snowflower, but just a bit of trading between the two bottom laners.
Yeah, just a little bit of back and forth right there, spell shield used, but Sanyut still wants this. He forces the flash. There's Lyra. Flash on Burrow. Goodbye, Secret. You can pound the ground in despair, but that doesn't actually stop Snowflower from killing you with the Ignite. And that'll be first blood over to the Anarchy support, and a very important kill early on here. That is pretty big.
And we look sideways at the priority first pick of Rek'Sai, but twice in a row, Lyra's made it work. And honestly, when you compare, again, his performance in games 2 and 3 to game 1, you can see they're starting to justify picking up these reliable early skirmish pick champions like Rek'Sai.
Well, Lyra's a playmaking jungler. I mean, we've seen how much of an effect he can have on the lanes. And so, in this particular instance, if they need him on that Rek'Sai and Gragas to really power up their lane phase, it is justified in a way.
But it'll be interesting to see if, let's say you're against CJ if you're Anarchy and you want to go for that early power spike, you can't really ban Gragas, lock in Rek'Sai, and leave up Lee Sin against a jungler like Ambition. Is this just because Catch isn't as comfortable on early power spike jungles like Gragas? That's maybe the question I'm wondering, given the drafting priorities.
Okay, there's the headbutt. Stun comes in. Can Lyra get the knock up? He's stopped in his tracks by the Pulverize, so no. But a little bit of a catch right there. Secret not really taking much damage.
Laning phase will go as expected. Blue buff's worn off, but we're getting to level 5. Suddenly going to be able to match a lot of the wave clearing that Karma's able to do. She just wants to push into the turret and just put down aggressive wards and roam potentially from with the Nidalee. But Nidalee on the bottom side of the jungle. The brittle health pull of Karma. I mean, she can't really opt into too many equal trades with Ixu, but when she can open up distance, you can see the burst is there.
Yeah, absolutely. Gets the root as well. And let's see what she... Oh, nice spear. He's going to dodge in. That forces the flash. Really nice spear, though, in between the minions for catch.
Yeah, threaded it through max range, draws out a summoner spell. Suddenly, Varus safer in a difficult lane. Karma's caught. She was overextended in this lane. Both CCs are huge. She has flash. She's going to be able to put down the root and opens up enough space. A nice play from Sol.
Yeah, but Anarchy here, they didn't commit to Sol right there. They knew that this Nidalee could be heading up to the top side, so they backed off at the right time, didn't go overly aggressive, and the counter gank destroying them underneath the turret. Snowflower lurking in a little bear costume in the brush, stun prepped.
Well, no wards available, so just being the human ward in this particular situation, she's in a vision range, and she's in experience range as well, so just able to sow seeds of doubt in Sarsen's head because they just don't know where this Annie's at.
I love sowing seeds of doubt. It's my favorite part of League of Legends. The mind games.
The vision games.
The vision games.
The blind pick, early pick, fizz games.
No, not
that seed of doubt?
No.
Where's the fizz going, Monty?
I love flex picks, as long as they're not fizz.
Okay. I'll find another one you dislike. And if I don't, the LPL will.
That's so true. The LPL is just designed to enrage me, if I'm smithy. That's what I've come to. Wow, nice charm. Forces the cleanse. Sasan without any mana to really follow up right there. So gets a summoner out for an ultimate.
And speaking of lack of mana, no mana on Mickey either. Honestly, didn't have quite the burst potential. It was 100% health coming through from Sasan. So could just walk away from the gank. Summoner trades come through. Ixu actually gets the red buff timer as far as I can tell. So that's a small victory for the Roam, but you can tell that pushing is going all right for the Maokai if he's able to push and roam against a Karma.
Well, did force the recall right there as well when he had control over the wave after the gank. And looks like going to back off for Anarchy right now. Retreat back into their own jungle. Ketch finds himself alone with a minion wave. Again, the warding on the bottom side, so good from Anarchy. Big, deep ring of wards to see if they're actually going to be going for any kind of play around this dragon, and playing with fire a little bit right there, but
it's what Annie trade. Does best.
It's true. Do trade ward for ward.
So Spenu, we talked about getting vision control around dragon seemed to be what parlayed a victory in both game one and two for the respective teams. Anarchy got on top of that early here, but now the Scuttle Crab and the Pink Wards are being cleared out, so both teams jockeying for what has proved to be a significant and game-winning advantage in the first two games.
But they have pressure, and are they going to go for this? They have a ward on the blue buff. They know it's being done. They can actually just go for the dragon right now if they want to. A little aggression. That's a lot of damage.
Snowfire level 4 from all the roaming, so a little bit behind in experience compared to Alistar.
Oh, there we go, and flash. So second ult by Mickey, second summoner spell burned, also dodging the piercing arrow. So Mickey really doing a good job controlling this lane right now, making Varus fearful. And remember, they opted into this matchup with the Varus. They chose this.
The only happiness for Sarsen is that two all-in attempts blowed one summoner each. Theoretically, the cleanse will be up for the third. Of course, if there's any sort of help from Rek'Sai, it might not be enough. But so far, so good in surviving what is a self-counterpick Dade-esque laning choice.
Didn't always work out so well for Dade.
It's true. Especially recently.
Well, why play League of Legends if you're a coward, Papa Smithy?
That's true. Dade and Sarsen, both truly men on the Rift.
Okay. Still no movement to that dragon quite yet. Mickey wants to find somebody.
Wants to all in.
He
again,
does.
Let's be real. Doesn't even have the Spirit Rush. Now he doesn't have 400 health, so that worked out pretty well for Sarsen.
Sasan checked one part with one skill and then checked the other part with the piercing arrow. So all of his arrows used for various different portions of the brush. Snowflower.
Arrows, spears, so much poke coming through. This is the poke we alluded to in Champion Set that obviously they've picked into. But longer this game goes, Ixu starts to stack items. The Home Guard backline threat with the excellent warding from Anarchy. looms as a really big threat, and Spenu just haven't really forced the envelope. In fact, they're behind in gold because of the first blood.
Well, and that's the thing, is that Nidalee is very effective. Snowflower gets all in right here. Very, very low. Sangyun pulling back. Now, there's still a ton of summoners, so not really likely that Snowflower was going to die right there. But again, Nuclear and Secret finding the better end of a trade.
Will this at least get them Dragon control, potential vision? Remember, there's three pink wards down around Dragon, and he's just trying to push away. They do not want to give away this important first Dragon, and it looks like they've been successful.
Anarchy has to back right now, but will they just collapse on it at the moment? With Lyra there, it would be really difficult to take that because they don't have control over mid, and Sossen has to play pretty far back under his turret at the moment.
He has cleanse back up, so definitely the solo kill potential for Mickey's not there. But with Lyra, we mentioned this could be it. Cleanse is nowhere near enough, and there's the kill for Mickey.
Well, didn't even have a chance to use it because the char missed, and it just didn't matter in the end. Now, Spenu going to respond with a dragon right here. The question is, are they going to get out safe? With the TP, you got to wonder, no real mana on any of these champions right now. Spell Shield to get a little back, but Sangyun over the wall. Alistair ulting. It's like he's going to get under the turret, but how long is that going to last? They could just waltz right through.
The conga line's coming, Monte Cristo.
The conga line of doom.
Definitely a very threatening conga line. Looks like they're going to pass over the kill to whoever they want, and it's going to be Sangyun.
Wow. The deadly conga line just tanking turrets. Inescapable.
Maokai does strike me as a conga line leader. He just kind of sauntered through. He's like, whatever. I'll lead them to victory. And victory in this case is killing the noble cow.
Yeah, the tiki Maokai needs to be made where he's just like a hollowed out pineapple. They sort of have like that tribal Maokai skin going on, but I think you really just need to go full tiki drink at some point.
Absolutely.
Have a little umbrella.
Pool party Lee Sin also would have been a formidable part of that conga line. He has a drink of his own. No Gragas on the Rift, of course, banned away this game, but things looking pretty good for Anakin in terms of the kills. Critically, Spenu steal away a dragon. They didn't really have the vision around dragon to really justify the dragon pickup, but for a pretty big cost.
Yeah, slow play from Anarchy, too, in terms of responding to that. And you know, Anarchy didn't really take an objective off that. They got, what, one kill? So.
Man, it's irritating laning against two champions that can poke you from out of vision, but that's the reality when you're against Varus Nidalee. Needs to hit the Chains of Corruption to really have a realistic kill pressure onto Ahri, but just chipping her away, just, you know, taking 400 health off of her. We see the Tib is used.
As Secret is gonna go down. He has no ult for a few more seconds. Unlucky. There it is. There's his ult. It's back now. Too bad it is too late.
240 damage crit from the Avarice Blade to Avarice Blade actually making something done in a skirmish. Plus 2 gold also on the kill of the cow.
Nice. What a massive victory for Avarice Blade.
The
laning phase has been.
Speaking of laning phases, Karma, honestly, that's all she's been doing. She's been sticking in the lane, hasn't teleported around. Just defensive teleports as far as we can tell. Nuclear's been completely chased away. Snowfire has stun available. It's a very early spell shield, but enough to walk under turret and make a turret dive just not realistic for Anarchy.
Yeah, still again, how did Anarchy win the last game? They started denying the Sivir with the proxy farming and taking over the bottom side of the map on blue side, getting that blue buff, and Catch just can't do anything. So this is following a very similar script to the last match. And
I mean, the script of the last one had that kind of left turn where Spenu should have had the first dragon and then were just like, we don't want to finish this, you guys have it. This time they actually did pick it up, but as you mentioned, everything else really going well for Anarchy.
Yeah, Ixu also has been holding on to a lane that kind of difficult in terms of that poke when you're a melee champion. Mickey trading with Sossen under his turret. Sossen a little bit out of mana, but here's a difference. Sangyun tries to dodge, but still gets hit by the pulv, has to flash at the end.
Yeah, flashes the headbutt to get away, so no sort of mini stun in the end. Sossen super low in mid.
Mickey just gave up at the end right there.
It's been a war of attrition between Mickey and, I guess, Nidalee and Varus in the mid lane. Lyra's doing a lot of damage to the turret. It's going to be chased away, though. Have to respect the damage from the Magus enchant, Nidalee, which I guess we won't be seeing for too much longer with Magus being phased out of the league.
Well, whatever.
That's some real fighting words there, Monte Cristo. Yeah, whatever. Runeglaive just means Evelynn will be stronger.
I know. It's okay.
Watch is happy.
I don't really mind the change from Magus to the Runeglaive.
The Nidalee and Fiddlesticks players out there probably says we're going to see a replay of the mids. It's a big damage trade. Chains of Corruption under the turret. So that was a very important skill shot to hit. Cleansed away the Ignite. So that's the only reason. So honestly, used his summoners very well. For once, he had them layered. Speaking of laying, we saw some damage layering potential as they're really brawling it up.
Oh, Catch just gets turned on right there. The pop from the Maokai ultimate and the Prey Seeker bursting that Nidalee down. Yeah, Catch not really respecting the turnaround.
Oh,
nice burst.
Mantrid Q burst was massive on a Maokai.
Yeah, Ixu also just flashing late right there. He got hit and then flashed and died anyway.
Not covering himself in glory.
No. That's a good phrase for misplays.
No.
The glory covering was absent. Oh, here we go. Flash Timbers. And can they get enough down? Exhaust is onto Mickey. Is there enough damage? It looks like there's barely enough. Mickey does not escape, though. Soul with the TP and the Empowered Q. He lands the root as well for the double kill.
And that's just a delayed triple coming through for Karma. Okay, had the Merlin Omicron, now going to have probably go for an Innis Large Rod. We saw the utility of Karma in mid, but now we're going to see a Karma who's actually ahead in terms of items. Yep, Innis Large Rod picked up very early.
Good reaction from Sol here on some of these ganks.
Shield being max second. This is going to be a formidable shield. Honestly going to need it. We've talked about all the backline threat. Just adding on a lazy, what, 600 health with the AP scaling could be very significant.
Yeah, it's a pretty massive ability to chew through of your Anarchy, especially Mickey, who really wants to burst down one of those targets quickly and then turn that fight into a 5v4. They have to make sure they get Soul on lockdown right here so that he can't use some of these abilities.
Is free to open up to something like Merc Treads, potentially, to deal with the Charms, and the Charms have been so on point by Mickey this series and the two games we've seen from the Ahri. Of course, could just be an Abyssal Scepter. I think Merc Treads into AP stacking is probably the right way to go.
I think with Charm and Annie on the enemy team, you definitely want to go Merc Treads right here.
I hope so. Maybe both, even.
So. Second Dragon is live, and Anarchy has the pressure again. They've been dominating these lanes, and they're not going to commit to that tower right there. They're just going to turn around and hit the dragon instead. They have a pink ward. There is no vision for Spenu.
And the vision game's so important for Anarchy to get aggressive vision around the blue side area, because the only way they lose these team fights is if they take significant poke beforehand. With all this vision monopolization, it's far too high risk for Spenu to opt into the poke game. And Catch, man, he is definitely found out in top.
Yeah.
Pretty in the ward. A green ward, no less.
And they're going to lose a turret as a result of that. No more fear for Mickey just to push up. No more fear in bottom side either. As again, the very deep invasion, the multi-man invasion from Anarchy descends upon the lower jungle of Spenu. And that's going to mean more creeps denied at this bottom. And this is how Sungyun got like a 50 CS lead in the last game. And he's doing it again.
And
oh, nice actually
game,
steal on the Gromp there from Nuclear.
So it was about stealing away the blue. It was about getting dragon control. This game, with such a landslide pressure advantage in mid, all that defensive vision just means that Mickey can go for the poke onto Varus and then kite downwards to his, what, almost complete vision of the blue side jungle. So empowering Mickey to play aggressive is something that's worked out so well for them.
Silver is in a rough position right now. There's so many people. Charm zoned out. Soul's down here, though. Can they turn this around? TP going to be used by Ixu. And blue buff looks like it was grabbed by Catch. And the TP onto the Rek'Sai tunnel canceled. So Ixu just going to trade that for a top tier one.
Awkwardly, that means that Ixu has a very delayed teleport timer compared to Soul. So that might be significant in about 2 minutes time, maybe a minute 30. Ixu trying to answer the push that already came through from Sol and Catch in the top lane, but just chipping away at the top lane turret.
And there you go. Miss on the Tibbers, but there's enough follow-through combo.
The flash, we'll headbutt, pulverize, assassination as Leer is taking a lot of damage. Remember, Sol was the big benefactor of the early game. Each of these Qs does so much damage, and you can't kite. Karma gets in during the tunnel as well, and Sol's running away with his top lane.
Well, he's becoming very dangerous, but how much can you actually do on this Karma?
That's exciting thing we get to find out, Monty. We're going to see a farmed, fed solo lane Karma. What can that do in what is a poke kite comp from Spinner?
Well, they're going to get priority on this turret right now. At the very least, they want to clear it out with the Culling. Sangyu taking a big, big Q hit.
Goes for the re-engage, gets the tether, but it's going to be broken. Spenner's not going to end this turret pushing game. Ixu doesn't have teleport, so we will not see any home guard plays. Just has to sit in lane and slowly wave through and watch the turret fall. It is importantly, though, a turret disadvantage despite the poke comp for Spenner, 2-3.
Yeah, and the gold just much more evenly distributed on the Anarchy side. I feel like if Sol gets locked down now, he is going to be in a world of hurt. I mean, he has the Merc Tread, so that is less of an issue. He did go for that item with the Null Magic Mantle, and he has the Needlessly Large Rod, perhaps going to be turning into a Zonya's. We'll see if he wants that for protection or whether he's just going to go straight up for a death cap.
I mean, I personally prefer the Lulu build, just going for the AP. You're being looked at for the consistent shield. Your shield is such a big chunk of health. I believe it's 0.9 scaling between the Mantra'd effect. So we're talking about 430 base plus percent Mantra.
Oh, jeez.
Sarsen's dead. No, actually survives right at the end. No Ignite put down. That's only the Merlinomicon debuff on the Hunt popped.
Wow, that was a lot used to try and counteract that. Sassen still incredibly poked out right here. They did use Spirit Rush for it. No summoners from Mickey. Ignite would have meant 100-0 there for Sassen.
But it seems like it's back to the turret pushing game. Sivir eventually gets chased away. Waiting to see if we're going to see an engage. Nuclear.
There we go. W right onto Nuclear. Nuclear gets chucked down and killed by Snowflower nearly immediately. Sol trying to back off right now. He's getting very low. Will get the speed. However, he's on the tail end of a Culling, and he makes it out. There's the pounce. Not enough to take out Sangyun as he pops the Summoner Seal. The heal to survive that burst. And that'll be 3-0. For Anarchy now, they're going to try and push up, but there's still a lot of wave clear on the side of Spenu. Their major wave clearers have survived. I mean, they have wave clear in all three lanes, so.
They absolutely do, but that's what happens when a poke comp gets collapsed on. You're going to see some collateral damage. In this case, 3 kills being passed over to Anarchy. The objective game, though, they're only going to be able to spend that gold because pushing against a Varus and Karma who's lived. That's a futile exercise.
And the scariest thing about that, Papa Smithy, was the fact that that was just Righteous Glory in a flash. That wasn't a teleport and a home guard engage, which is going to be much more deadly to that back line. Sol was trying to poke him out and slow him down, but...
I mean, that time it was a mistake from Nuclear. He just got Tibbers despite the fact there was no flash of Old Snowflower. Didn't even have his own personal Righteous Glory. That was just an overextension and a late spell shield. So Spenner will hope that's a once-off, but this is the sort of punishment that comes out to a Pokemon that doesn't get ahead in the mid-game, and they're 5,000 gold behind and behind in objectives. There's still the potential. They have such amazing Siege and Wave Clear that maybe they can pull off this game in the late game, but execution heavy for our 2-17 team. That's difficult ask for Spenner.
It is, and not only that, but now they're going to have to start playing the deadly face check the Baron game on a team that can close the gap so quickly. You have to dodge any flash now with the Tibbers, Charm, Twisted Advance. There's so many tools for Anarchy to punish your face chucking, and they have to sink some wards in there. Best thing Anarchy can do is just play around these objectives and make Spenu contest.
They really want to pick up their blue buff Assassin. It's been denied a couple of times. It's just spawning now. If Faris can pick that up, they have basically poked for days. They've given away a free dragon. This would be massive if it came through. Can't quite get the steal, does Lyra. It's a second dragon to Anarchy, but crucially, because Spenner picked up the first, not quite that same five dragon pressure this game.
Yeah, not at all. Ixu going head to head with Sol, but he can barely break that shield. But Sol Not going to be doing a lot of damage to this Maokai with all the health, and now that the Spectre Scowl is there also. So Anarchy setting up for a siege here.
Amazingly, no wave clear here because it's just Alistar and Nidalee. They can poke though, so the turret will live. But nice rotation coming through from Anarchy, spotting out somehow a wave clear deficiency on the Spenu side.
And really, that's just Spenu's problem, that you have these three champions that can wave clear, and you can't get any of them into a lane with two or three members of Anarchy in it. That is not good in terms of how you assign lanes. Now Iksu and Mickey are here taking a bit of poke, but also getting some minion damage down. Soul gets hit out by the charm.
Of course, lower duration because of the Merc Treads is significant. Snowfire has flashed, not quite Righteous Glory. Anarchy did some sloppy diving in game twos. So there's always the potential they get too cute and there's a cleanup coming through from someone on Spenu. They should be grouping out their threats. Sivir, Varus, and Karma should never be within multiple stun range from the Annie. So given all the initiation options, that might not be significant, but there are ways for Spenu to try and bait a bad engage from Anarchy.
All right, Songyun goes back, finishes the Bloodthirster. Nice item for him right now against the low armor composition from Spenu, needing that shield just to survive some of the burst and the poke. But this is where Anarchy really needs to move on for this Baron. That's the objective they have to threaten to successfully close this game, because you can't rely on Spenu just to mess up and leave some of these tier twos undefended. Get the wards down, get enough pinks down, and get the vision control so that you could just do it.
Nothing more important with or against a poke team. Whenever a poke comes in the game, Baron can be so important. So oppressive if you have it. And so now Mickey's fallen low, but they don't quite have the CC or engage that Anarchy have in spades. So what can they get away from the fact that they've done some excellent poking in mid?
Well, they can clear out this top wave with the Ahri. Anarchy can at the very least, but can Spenu actually put down the pressure? Mickey getting a lot of health back, actually.
Maokai's coming through the river as well. They have a pink ward on their flank, so they'll see him coming. They start to back away. Sivir ult used. They've also used the Karma, but they're still getting engaged. Where will this fight go?
Oh, yeah, they're starting to move forward. Stoneflower eats the Chain of Corruption nearly immediately. Catch starting to kite back. Secret still in the front line, but taking the focus fire. He is going to actually go down at the end. Songyu dashing forward to clean up the kill, and that's a 4-for-1. Bit of a rocky engage on the start there. Iksu having to get the W, but now they're turning it back around. Lyra wants this.
Very nice cutting back, gets the kill onto Lyra. Lyra got too cute. We're gonna see the re-engage. Remember, with Karma, they have so much re-engage, but speaking of re-engage, Catch is dead.
And there we go, Songyun looking like he wants to get out of that. Iksu dies, but there's just not enough HP on Anarchy. They can't keep engaging like this, turning it around, but Lyra right there, you just don't want to use a flash Rek'Sai on Burrow to try and turn that around. There's simply not enough CC to buy you time to get the reversal right there. You need to wait for that one. You already used the abilities you had to engage. Just go ahead and back off. So they're going to lose a turret just for that turnaround when it was a one for none. And Mickey comes back, full HP.
Three low members, Rek'Sai's here as well. Alistar headbutts him away. Okay, they don't quite get the pick onto
no
Nuclear.
No mana from Soul right now. And Iksu has TP, here he comes. He's going to be zooming in from the side. Sassin certainly dead at this stage. There's the sapling. They're gonna get him with the W. Soul will fall to the follow-up from Mickey. Nuclear very low. Are they going to go Sivir hunting or are they going to go for the Baron?
Yeah, they really need they to just pick Baron. Up the Baron. It's a very nice juke from Nuclear actually to open up as much distance as possible. He's probably going to be able to get away. But have Anarchy spent too long chasing Nuclear to pick up the Baron? The answer looks like yes.
I don't know about that. Soul would have to get here pretty quickly.
Already fighting for vision around the area. There's still Alistar in the area as well. Seems like an overreach from Anarchy when Baron was looking like a very realistic objective.
I still think it was. I still think they could have gone for it right there. I know they were worried about catch potentially, but let's take a look at how this unfolded. The re-engage, I mean, Lyra just gets so greedy.
The flash unburrowed from Lyra, though. You have to respect the fact that with this reworked Karma, the speed boost comes up so often. The mantra's up so often. There again, was the re-engage from both teams. So Catch gets caught in the front line. He was just far too aggressively positioned. But the damage from the three members alive is super high. So it was surprisingly very even skirmishing between these two teams.
And the worst part of that about that from Lyra is that everyone on Spenu had their flash up. The odds of that working are insanely low. If everyone had their flash down on Spenu, absolutely try and make that move. But considering that it was counteracted immediately with the kite and that he was killed immediately, you just can't make that kind of move. You have to know what your enemy's summoners are.
Feels like Sol has adapted to the fact that there is no Aegis on the lineup from Anarchy, going for very late haunting guys, but still the Magic Pen's going to be doing a lot of duty. Doesn't have Sorcerer's Shoe, so a bit of early Magic Pen means that Q-Poke's going to hit even harder. Secret's looking aggressively for a pick, can't find one. Dragon's live. It'd only be an answering second dragon, but they do not want to give up a third dragon to Anarchy.
Mickey, still chunked out. Okay, here comes the dragon. Can they actually put this one through?
It's falling low. Actually, releashes back to 3,000 health, so it's plenty of time for Poke to come through.
And there we go. The culling is interrupted, actually, by Secret, but everyone else caught up in a choke right there. Dragon goes over to Anarchy. Secret trying to live through his ultimate. There's a huge, huge Tibbers on the back while they actually just finish off Secret. Whoa. Great flash to prevent any kind of turnaround. Here's the Karma speed coming through again, but Ixu is just so damn tanky.
And the cooldown on this Mantra is super low. Will be up again in about 5-6 second time. With the cleanse being used by Sarsen, they got away from what was a three-person Annie Tibbers, so that was surprising to say the least.
Yeah, they're still just going to take the dragon and back off right now. Spenu can't really do a Baron at this point in time. You can see Ixu just checking around. They don't all recall simultaneously. Just in case, they'll stagger him out. Lyra asserting some presence over the pit already with the Void Rush. Smart recalls there from Anarchy.
It's just nice to see a competitive game after what was two very one-sided first two games of this series. So these teams both struggling. Spenu putting up a fight and what would be their first match win if they could find a way to make the poke stick and win this game.
Yes, it would. Well, I think he's zooming out right now, using that Orb of Deception to get to his objective just a hair faster.
Spenu actually taking a leaf out of Jyn'Erz's playbook. When they were running a poke comp, they were really going heavy on the warding totems. Triple warding totem this game, and just the one sweeper from Secret. We saw Quadra from Jyn'Erz as Captain Jack actually invested in one himself, but just going for the safer option of checking the Baron. Because Baron, as we mentioned, against a poke comp, suddenly the poke and the siege isn't really an option. And if a poke comp picks up the Baron, man, it's oppressive to deal with the split push. So
yeah,
probably need the one scrying orb this game.
So, I mean, there's the, actually, there it is. Catch just gonna get blown up. Mickey punishing him when they didn't have enough wards in the river. They had a couple pinks, Anarchy did, so that meant that Catch went in the cougar form to try and clear them out, but that is going to be a dead kitty.
And this is definitely the objective you wanna focus on. If you're Anarchy, Baron is the easy one to pick up with all the wave on Spenu's side. No jungler alive. Spenu are in the area, but I think they look resigned to giving it up.
Well, and there's no tank here either, but that's going to be the secure from Lyra. Easily done with a smite. And no one responding. Now, both TPs are going to be back up very shortly. Sue's on that nice brief cooldown, and his will return and be useful now.
Mentioned the lack of a tank at that particular Baron. Honestly, Spenu have a tank for about the 6 second duration of Alistar's ultimate. And then just super, super squishy. That's why we talked about how execution heavy this comp is with directed, targeted engage from the likes of Homeguard, Twisted Advance, from the Unburrow that unfortunately Lyra undid himself with a bit too much aggression in the previous fight. There's a lot of ways for Anarchy to deal with Spenu, with the Baron especially. Poking Wayfair doesn't mean that much when you got Baron buff minions.
Yeah, that is very true. They have the wave clear, but it's going to take so much to get rid of these waves, to eliminate them from the front of the base, and here we go.
Specifically, Karma is going to have the hardest time because with the fact that the Q stops on the first target, the Mantra Q just isn't going to get the same purchase in terms of massive wave clear. Backline still can be taken down, but instant clear, which is almost always the way for Karma. That much harder when we're talking about Baron buff minions.
Yeah, Mickey doing his Mickey thing and split pushing. We saw them end very effectively like this in the last game as Sasin gets zoned out of the base gate right there, but Mickey has to use his ultimate to do so. And Soul just got a recall. There's only one tier two left, and that's going to be the one that Ixu is splitting in. So 1-3-1 here, more or less.
Baron buff duration. Can they break the base during the Baron buff duration? I will say that if they break the base, I think this is basically a game you can pencil in for Anarchy. But if the base stays strong, if there isn't the super minions pushing against, and there's that three minute period between Baron buff falling away and the next Baron buff coming up, there is still windows for Spenu to break the base themselves with all the siege they have, but they need a catch to do that.
Oh, you are forever the optimist, Papa Smithy.
Well, I mean, completely writing them off, it's not quite the 10,000 gold lead. They haven't quite broken the base. They have a lot of damage, it's just they don't have much tankiness. So an individual mistake from Anarchy, someone dying for free, there still is a fight Spenu can win. It's just not the percentage play. It's still unlikely.
Yeah, quite unlikely. Well, see if they can hold out here. I mean, a lot of this Baron buff has been wasted already without even getting one turret from it.
Not even the split push, as you mentioned, getting that top outer turret.
Yeah, they have to do more with what they've been given. They've been slowly working on these towers, and finally looks like that's going to go down. And will they take the inhibitor with it? Lyra to provide the front line and the zoning for Mickey right there. They sent four people down. Snowflower showing up alongside Sangyun at the naked in him. That's going to be it.
That's the pass mark for the Baron buff I mentioned. Now suddenly, strategic options for a Pokemon and that has to deal with those Baron buff minions are pretty low. Seeker takes so much damage.
You cannot engage like that against this Anarchy composition. That is just playing into their hands. And Mickey finds his way into the back line, but this is going to be it. Big, big Tibbers. Secret takes the brunt of the damage at the start of the fight. Chain of Corruption locks down a couple members of Anarchy, and they're trying for more roots, but that's a flash, and then an unburrow, and that's going to be it. As Sangyun cleaves through the enemy line and gets right back all the way to the fountain.
Yeah, one small mistake with the flash unburrow almost cost Anarchy in the mid game, but a flash triple unburrow got them the important picks they need to be able to finish the game. Spenu still can't pick up that first series win, and Anarchy, they made it look difficult, but it looks like they're finally going to get it, but they're very low. Doesn't matter when Sangyun's so strong.
Well, it may actually double kill for Nuclear again. And Anarchy on the run, despite nearly killing that Nexus.
Almost saw a repeat of Pen Today video that we saw previous this series.
You get one good ricochet off right there and everyone dies.
I mean, Lyra probably wouldn't die to the ricochet, but the next autos with the Fleet of Foot, almost certainly it's going to be the fourth dragon as well. Going to be delayed, but still, I'm going to say it. You can maybe even upgrade to permanent marker. It's looking like a win for Anarchy.
Is that the permanent marker, Pop Smithy's seal of approval? Is that what you sign off on a game?
Well, I said if they could break the inhibitor, you could pencil it in. I think you can upgrade to the permanent marker now. Maybe you shouldn't be writing permanent marker on a whiteboard, but on a piece of paper, you're probably fine.
I think on a whiteboard's okay for this game. I feel pretty confident about its outcome.
But then you're wasting a whiteboard for Anarchy vs. Spenny.
Oh, that's a great point. You know, League of Legends taught me not to misuse my resources.
I mean, that's pretty much the name of the game at top-level competitive League of Legends. I don't know if this is the series that really drains that into your head, as we've seen Anarchy, especially in Game 2, get a bit questionable. Lyra gets very cute face-checking, but this is where the gold lead starts to get oppressive. 10,000 gold, a fifth dragon, if they really can't find a way to finish the game in the next 4 minutes. And Snowfire is just patrolling around, looking for the big engage. Talisman and Righteous Glory with a friendly Righteous Glory. Movement speed buff from the third dragon. Only flash for the complete go time play from Snowflower.
Yeah, they got double glories, of course, one on the Maokai as well. And they really want to move up on this one. They should have a pretty easy time zoning them off the turret. Spenu can't be collapsed on in a pincer maneuver right here, or they will just all die. They don't have enough tanks to actually deal with that. Ixu has decided that he is going to face tank this turret. Super minions starting to stack up inside the base itself. Will Anarchy go for the last kill?
Conga line leader Ixu, he's actually got the he's bought the 400 gold. That actually means that when people follow him, they get faster. So, you know, he's role-playing.
Got to get more conga in this game.
All the conga up in this League of Legends.
Okay. Last turret. There's Secret going in. He finds something he likes. Sangyun with the instant cleanse, though. And there's the Chain of Corruption. Just going to slow down the advance of Anarchy. Doesn't actually hit anyone else. Mickey has to pop his Zhonya's on the side.
Yeah, Sol does manage to occupy Mickey, so it's 4v4 on the top side. Chase Mickey away. Delaying the inevitable is what we call the lack of finish. Remember, there is no Nexus turrets whatsoever, so it's hard to say why they're really trying to break the base in the top.
Yeah, they absolutely could have just gone through the mid or bottom lanes and followed up on those minions, but you know what?
Baron time.
It's time for more Barons, Papa Smithy.
All of the Barons, Monte Cristo.
Baron is the crutch for teams that don't know how to close games. That's what I say.
I mean, Anarchy have shown very clearly they know how to finish games. It's turret dive at every opportunity. They did it last game. It almost failed them. For some reason, they've gone for the safer choice. Maybe they see their 4 dragon stack and they think, okay, we can definitely dive if we get Baron and 5th dragon. There's not even that much to dive. That's the issue. They don't even have Nexus turrets to dive. This is their confusion. How can you dive if there's nothing to dive, Monte Cristo?
Wow, Mickey may actually go down here. There's an auto and a flash Q. Is it going to be enough? Though Sol gets caught out. Everyone zipping over with Righteous Glories, and he is eventually going to succumb to Ixu and the Culling, but a lot more people dropping. Nuclear actually still going kind of crazy in the back line. He's trying to follow up. Ixu so tanky, though. Can they actually live through this to defend their base? Still a lot of super minions, but Mickey gets caught out, and there's a full HP Nexus. So this repeated attempt to take down the third inhib for Anarchy is actually costing them an insane amount.
But it might cost Spenu more. We're actually seeing super minions pushing onto the base. They should be able to kill them, but it does take a lot of time to chunk through. There's a smite used to try and clear. The desperate clearing continues. I can only assume Anarchy are making plays to increase their GPM, but dying doesn't really help them much in the pursuit of what is just a mathematic tutorial win, third inhibitor turret.
I just don't know why you wouldn't walk in with 5 super minions that you can help the waves with the Baron buff right now. There's absolutely no reason to take out this third inhibitor or split push or do anything besides walk in.
I got nothing to say, Monte Cristo. This is where Dole would make a funny joke about an 80s cartoon.
Oh.
The 5th dragon spawning at 1 minute 20. Apparently they need that to finish the game because the open front door and sign that the party's about to start isn't enough for them. They still need more of an RSVP.
Well, at least Spenu has some ability to poke right here, so Anarchy can find creative new ways to not finish this game.
It's worth noting that 3 inhibitors are up, so the immediate pressure on the base, barring a crazy split push from Mickey, who's at least threatening such a maneuver.
Why?
For some reason, he's split pushing the
Why?
Top turret, though, because he
Why?
Needs to get that turret down.
Why?
They need the turret.
They are so hung up on this one tower. I mean, Mickey doesn't have any kind of teleport to get back into this fight either. Why is Spenu even responding to this?
Because it's the lucky turret, Monte Cristo, the lucky top inhibitor turret. We talked about Rabbit's Foot last game. This is the only thing I can possibly see is that you just need to take out the top inhibitor turret.
And Spenu actually gives up their position on the dragon. They should just... What is happening? Sol has TP. Just send Sol up there.
He needs to remain grouped, apparently. Snowfire gets poked out. There are things happening in this game.
I mean, all the wrong things. Absolutely.
Getting a tutorial on what not to do from Anarchy and Spenu. Two teams that haven't done a lot of winning, finding it difficult to win, I guess, shouldn't be so surprising.
Okay, Culling rakes across the composition. They catch Sol. That's going to be it.
Sol
gets picked in the brush. Now they're going to follow up. Mickey gets poked, but uses the Zhonya's on the Chain of Corruption. Now Ketch finds himself on the side. Mickey still had a charge, so he's going to take out Nuclear as well with the help of his ultimate, and they just pile on through. Using all of that crowd control, Anarchy finally finds the pick they want, and in a rather torturous end of this game, it will finally mercifully be over.
And Anarchy will have their third series win. Will there be a surrender? No. Much more mana has been shown. Mickey, man, he might actually get this Raptor. Will he get the Raptor? We're not sure. We will update you post-match about the Raptor, but apparently Anarchy win the game.
In the end of all things, Mickey refuses to be with his team at the Nexus once again. And wow, that was something, Papa Smithy. Anarchy gets the 2-1. Spenu continues to be winless in this league.
But we are left with the eternal question as I stare at this mini-map. Did Mickey get the Raptor?
Well, some things are not for men to know, Papa Smithy. I'm sorry.
What can you do?
Well, we have another match coming up next that will be Najin versus Jin Air, which I imagine is going to be quite different than this last match that Anarchy just came out of victorious.